It's the Ramada Inn pre-race show from the outskirts of Nashville, Tennessee. 43 drivers getting ready to make some beautiful music here at the Nashville Super Speedway. It's race number 8 for the Busch Series in 2003. More importantly, it's their first standalone. Yesterday, 16 drivers broke the old track qualifying record, and Glenn Jarrett is standing by with the man who was the quickest of the quick.
And Randy LaJoy continues his love affair here at Nashville. He was had two fourths his first two times here at Nashville Super Speedway. Won the last race at the fairgrounds, but it's been a while since you won, man. You got the pole, you were fast in happy hour. What about your chances today, Randy?
The Kleenex car is very good. It unloaded very well. This is a nice racetrack. I like it. You know, being a butt pole, haven't done that and since St. Louis last year, and outside pole at Phoenix. But really, the guys gave me a great race car off the truck. Carl Wagner gave us a good motor, and then, you know, Kleenex come out with these dinner napkins, so we got to bring them up front all day today.
Well, Randy, good luck to you today. He is very, very overdue for a win. Now, joining me on pit road today here is former ARCA champion, my colleague, Bill Venturini.
Thanks, Glenn. Well, yesterday, while this gentleman over here was over at Martinsville qualifying a cup car, Mike McLaughlin put his car strongly in the field, but there's going to be a driver change. Todd Bodine is going to have to start last. But that's not the only thing you've got. This is, what, the first time this year that you've now done double duty. What's it look like for today and the rest of the year?
Well, you know, I think there were 6 conflicts that we had for this year, and the way we've got it figured, I can race all 6. Some more of them we're going to have to do like this week and have Mike practice qualify the car, and then I'll show up and race it. But there's a couple that I can actually go back and forth and do both. But it gets a little strenuous, but it's not too bad. You got a good crew on both sides. It makes it a lot easier. Today, they were pretty happy with the car. A little bit too tight, but they made some changes this morning. I know, you know, very confident in what Mike says in the car. And I know he's going to have a good balance, and that's what it's going to take. You know, the track's going to be a lot hotter today. It's going to be a little different with that Hoosier rubber, and, you know, we're starting in the back. Get settled in, get a few laps, get used to it, and then try to drive to the front.
Well, thanks. Let's go back upstairs to Mark and your brother, Brett.
A week ago, Talladega Super Speedway, the scene. Johnny Sauter cuts down a tire, lap 9. 21 cars pile in.
Ouch. You know, this just a terrible situation early on in the race. Took out a lot of real contenders for the win. You know, contact, just awesome. Unbelievable damage.
Casey Kane really took a lick at the end of that wreck. Thankfully, all the drivers were able to walk away. We probably, though, here at Nashville Super Speedway, won't see that kind of wreck today. Thankfully.
Yeah, thankfully. Nashville's a different type of racetrack. 1.33 miles, tri-oval. Great competition here. Great racetrack for these guys to showcase their talents without any Winston Cup regulars.
Now, one thing about the race today, we should see a second groove here at Nashville. We haven't seen that in the past, but in happy hour yesterday, you saw it starting to come in, and that should be some good side-by-side racing today, we hope.
Absolutely. You know, this racetrack, concrete surface, single lane early on through practice and qualifying, but the second lane starting to come in. And thankfully for these guys that got to go to the back of the pack with engine changes, brother Todd having to come over, starting the rear with his points leading team, these guys hope a second lane comes in and hope it comes in a hurry.
Now, when you win here at the Nashville Super Speedway, a very special trophy awaits you. It's a Gibson guitar. Glenn Jarrett standing by with one guy who desperately wants to strum one in victory lane.
Oh, no question about it, Mark. And Jason Keller could do it today. He starts on the outside pole. He'll give Randy LaJoy a good run for his money. Jason, great history here. You've had a fast car since you got here. Your chances today.
They're real good. We came here and tested a couple weeks ago, and the Albertsons guys just gave me a fantastic race car. So qualifying up front, I'm a little uneasy about going on the outside of LaJoy going into turn one, but once we get everything lined up, I think we got a real good race car.
Well, good luck to you. You know, Mark, Jason is the only guy who has run all 3 races here at Nashville with 3 top 5 finishes.
He's a pretty tough guy on the concrete. Don't go away. More coming up on the Ramada Inn pre-race show from the Nashville Super Speedway in Lebanon, Tennessee. The Nashville Super Speedway, certainly a fan-friendly place for the kids, as you can see, and for the more daring. I don't know if I'd do that. The street's named after some great NASCAR drivers like Darrell Waltrip and Dale Earnhardt. Music City, USA, a little dancing. Our patriotic pride. And, of course, some Tennessee walking horses.
Welcome back to the Ramada Inn pre-race show. This is race number 8 for the Busch Series in 2003. Here's a look at what happened in the first 7.
Trouble for the 21. Early leader, Kevin Harvick.
Kevin, stop. The can's in there.
Dale Earnhardt Jr., under caution, will come to the checkered flag. Oh, trouble turn 1. 2 cars hard at the wall. 1 is Mike Wallace. Shane Meehl there, 48, is the other.
You got a problem, Shane?
Yeah.
You don't know how to drive? What?
Jamie McMurray has now won 3 of his last 6 Busch Series starts. Joe Nemechek off turn 4 for his 13th NASCAR Busch Series victory.
He's going to close the gap, but it's I think it's going to be too little too late. He's there, but he can't make the pass.
Try on the outside.
Off the left side, just like yesterday. Here they come. It's a trap.
Checkered flag for Kevin Harvick.
It's been a while since we've seen a good old Kevin Harvick celebration. I think we're going to see one here.
The black flag is out for our race leader, Brian Vicker.
Oh, man, I did not do that.
Well, I don't know, Darrell. That's awfully. I don't know if I agree with that call.
I'll call that a half pass.
We had the car to win, and we was going to win this race, and it just got taken away from us.
Joe Nemechek takes the checkered flag. In, and there's the big one.
Man, there's a fuel pressure right here.
Oh boy, one to go.
You can see him wiggling back and forth. You heard him say, I've lost fuel pressure. I don't have all the fuel pressure.
This will be the longest lap of Dale Jr.'s life.
Don't pass that pace car.
And Dale Earnhardt Jr. wins it. With a last lap time of 2 minutes, 16 seconds.
It may only be the 70 miles an hour, but it was pretty exciting.
Here's a look at the point standings now. Todd Bodine, the leader, by 39 over Jamie McMurray. Ron Hornaday, Shane Meehl, Jason Keller round out the top 5. There you look at the rest of the top 10. Mike Wallace in that number 10 spot. And you know, Brett Bodine, when you look at that list, there's some Winston Cup drivers. It's a little top heavy, and right now the Bushwhackers are 7-0 in 2003. However, today we should see our 6th different winner of the year and hopefully our first Busch Series regular.
Well, that's what these guys are shooting for. This is a very important race on their schedule. Without the presence of a lot of Winston Cup guys, they feel the pressure, they feel the need for speed, and feel the need for a victory.
There's only 7 standalone events. They got to get it done, one of those 7.
That's exactly right, and today's going to be one of them.
Let's go downstairs to Bill Venturini.
Well, thanks, guys. I'm down here with the few, the proud, and the one and only Bobby Hamilton Jr. Last year, a 3rd, a 2nd. Yesterday, 2nd in happy hour. I think you've only got 1 spot left, buddy.
That's it. We got the car to win this thing. Different day. It ought to be freed up a little bit, less grip. It's what we needed. So we're looking forward to it. The Marines 4 Taurus is fast. Like I said, another great motor from Robert Yates and them guys. And it's time to get down to business.
Well, yesterday you mentioned something about hometown advantage, sleeping in your own bed. You look rested, and I know what an advantage like what that is. How was it for you?
It was great. And I mean, just eat at your normal restaurants. You can go home, do your own deal, and get here whenever you want, you know. The same deal that you normally do every day. And like you said, tons of rest and ready to go.
Well, he calls this place home, and we're at Nashville. Let's go to you, Glenn.
All right, thanks, Bill. David Green grew up racing in the Nashville area. It's been a while since you won a race. You've been fast off the truck, man. It's time to get a win.
Timberwolf Pontiac's great. Glenn and Nashville's been good to me in the past. A new racetrack, new facility, and we feel good about our chances today. But got to say a couple of things. Number one, hi to Jeff Purvis. Hoping to see him here this weekend, so hopefully he's rooting us on. And I got to say, our thoughts and our prayers are still with the Andy Kirby family. Andy lost his life about a year ago, and a great name in the Nashville area, great racer. And I want to say hi to his family and wish him the best.
Well, thanks a lot, David. That's typical David Green, always thinking of others. He has not won since 1996. He is way overdue, Mark.
He certainly is, and he's certainly one of the Busch Series regulars who could break through and grab a win today. More of the Ramada pre-race show coming up just after this. We'll be right back. a sunny Saturday in Rocky Top. Welcome back to the Ramada Inn pre-race show here at the Nashville Super Speedway. You know, there's a strong group of young drivers making a lot of noise on the Busch Series these days. Lately, however, one teenager in particular has really turned up the volume.
Could be a good day for the first time, Brian Vickers.
Brian Vickers has opened it up.
I believe, really, the guy who's the fastest car out there happens to be Brian Vickers in that five car. He's run extremely well all day long.
Getting set to settle it here. They will restart with 22 laps to go. And the black flag is out for our race leader, Brian Vickers.
I'm totally confused.
Oh, man, I did not do that.
Well, I don't know, Darrell. That's awfully. I don't know if I agree with that call.
I'll call that a half pass.
You know, it's not very often in racing when everything goes right. You know, the crew did an awesome job. The car wasn't that fast when we unloaded, but it was fast, and we drove a good race. The whole team did good. Just everything came together, and we dominated that race.
That five car is very, very fast.
That five car is eating them up.
And then somebody came on and said it's black flag, and I'm like, I mean, it just hit me. I was just like, oh, my God, for what? We're leading this race.
And a strange turn of events to this race for 19-year-old Brian Vickers.
I guess that's just how it goes. I mean, I'm not gonna bow down and agree with him and say, hey, you did the right thing, because I still disagree with it, but I respect it. I respect their decision, and I have to go along with it. I mean, I'm just happy to be racing in NASCAR. I mean, it's an awesome series.
I think there's going to be many more for that young man, though. 19 years old, I've watched him, Darrell, we've watched him the last 3 weeks. He's going to win his share of races.
You know, we've just slowly been better and better every week. We've had top three cars every week, and we're just trying to capture that win, you know, and then to go to Texas and have what happened, it hurts, but we're gonna rebuild, and the whole team's gonna use it as a fuel for the fire. We're gonna go after them. You know, the team has just been tremendously behind me. Hendrick Motorsports has been behind me, the sponsor, GMAC CarQuest, and it's an amazing feeling to be at Hendrick Motorsports and have everybody behind you. I mean, it's like a big family down there. You know, Jeff and Jimmy and Joe and Terry, they've helped me a tremendous amount. Anytime I have a question, I can call them, or I can go right over to the Cup Garage and they will answer any question and spend time with me. It's pretty awesome, you know, to have that support behind you. And the whole Hendrick Motorsports, it's awesome. I get no doubt.
When you're young and you get knocked down, it's a little easier to get up. And every time I look at Brian Vickers, it's like a grown-up howdy doody. Big smile, and that kid's going to have a lot of success on the Busch Series when it's over. Should get his first win this year.
Oh, I feel confident he'll get his first win and maybe his second and third. Who knows? You just sense the pride and the determination when you talk to Brian Vickers. The fact that he's a member of one of the greatest organizations in motorsports today. And is just feeling it and living it and enjoying it fully. And he is going to be awesome, and he's going to be tough to deal with on this Busch Series.
What a combination. The car owner, Ricky Hendrick, 23-year-olds. Brian Vickers just turned 19. They could be around for a while.
Yes, they could be. And be around for a while as a team. Keyword team. And that's what these guys are forming right now, a team that will be reckoned with for a long time to come in NASCAR racing.
Last night, Kyle Busch won the ARCA race here at the Nashville Super Speedway. The young guys are a hot property these days. How do you find them? What are you looking for?
Well, you know, we got all these car owners out looking for young guys. And, you know, they look in all the different kind of series, all the way back down to quarter midgets and go-karts and, you know, the local short tracks. This is where talent is made, these kind of racing and this kind of racetrack. And the car owners are out there looking for it. And, you know, obviously, Rick Hendrick and Ricky Hendrick have got a great sense for who can do it and who can't, and they've got a great young team right now.
Well, you know, Brett, if you're just a little bit younger, we could put you in that group, but sorry about that, buddy. You might not be on one of the scouting reports. Right now, there's going to be some great racing in Martinsville, Virginia tomorrow for a preview. Let's head up through that Blue Ridge Mountains and Steve Burns.
Thanks very much, Mark. Jeff Hammond, we have a powerhouse front row here in Martinsville for Sunday's race. Jeff Gordon scored his 43rd career pole. He lines up alongside Dale Earnhardt Jr., the driver with all the momentum from Talladega.
Yeah, he really does right now. As you're looking right now, the pole sitter right there, Jeff Gordon, who's obviously, he's elated about the fact right now that he's starting up front, going to have the best pit position. And there you see the guy right now who's really on a roll. And to me, if you want to win a Winston Cup championship, you've got to be able to get the short tracks down. got to come to a place like Martinsville, Richmond, and have very much a lot of success. And here lately, he's had solid runs here at a place like Martinsville. He needs to continue it.
Dale Earnhardt Jr., the only driver to finish in the top five in both events here at Martinsville. Okay, now, so you've got good pit selection via good qualifying. What do you do to your race car? What do you do to your driver for 500 laps?
Well, you got to, first thing you got to do, you got to put the lower gear in there. You got to open those brake ducts up, and you got to tell that driver, save your brakes, keep the nose on that race car, and whatever you can do to work on your patience to make this thing work here so you can better hook your race car up. I mean, that's the other thing, is slow down and go fast and try to keep running all over everybody who's in front of you.
You keep saying patience. That doesn't go together.
I know
well
it doesn't go together,
drivers.
But it works here. Believe me, if you want to win this race, you've got to learn how to slow down to go fast.
All right, Kenny Schrader and Rusty Wallace, a couple of veterans, also having a great run. They'll start inside the top 10. Let's go back to Nashville and Mark Garrow.
Lots of NASCAR coverage still to come this weekend, coming up later today, or should we say tonight, 7 p.m. Eastern time on FX. It's the Winston Cup final practice for the Virginia 500. And then tomorrow, NASCAR This Morning on Fox Sports Net at 10:30 Eastern time. And then the Winston Cup Series gets it on at 12:30 Eastern time on Fox. On a beautiful day in Tennessee, the Stars and Stripes flying proudly. More of the Ramada Inn pre-race show in just a moment. We're back on the Ramada Inn pre-race show. Race number 8 for the Busch Series. We're at the Nashville Super Speedway. A big crowd is filing in here, and somebody has flipped the switch. You can hear, feel the electricity building as we get ever closer to the green flag. The crew's beginning to line up on pit road, getting ready for our pre-race activities. You see that each and every one showing their American pride, making some final adjustments as we head back down to pit road and Bill Venturini.
Thanks, Mark. You hear about pretty race cars. Well, I've got to have the prettiest hood in racing right now. Tell us all about it, Kevin.
First of all, I really have to thank Mike Curb and Curb Records for giving me this opportunity. We have we definitely have the best-looking passenger on our car. But, yeah, we're looking to have a good run. We just put this deal together on Monday, and we've been working real hard at the shop to get everything going. And I really have to thank everybody that's been pitching in and helping this deal out, because it's showing we have a good car, and I think we can go out here and win it.
Well, we hope so. And let's find Glendo somewhere on pit road here.
Right next door to you, Bill. Scott Riggs starts third today. He is the defending champion of this race. Last year, Scott, you won your first ever Busch Series victory here. You made it look easy. This week, it hasn't been easy, has it?
No, it hasn't been easy at all. Pretty proud of these guys on the Nesquik Ford Tours, though. They've worked off a hard. We were a long ways from where we needed to be when we unloaded here yesterday. And like I say, got to give my hats off to those guys. Made a lot of changes. I think we changed more on this car this weekend than we probably have all year long. So. Real happy with the car, real consistent. I feel like I can hustle the car around pretty good. Turns good for me, so you're just going to sit here. We've got a good qualifying effort, and track position is going to be real important today. So just going to try to hang out here in the top couple positions, if not the front, and just want to lead that last lap.
Good luck to you today, Scott. He has had tremendous success racing on concrete throughout his career, Mark.
He certainly has. Scott Riggs, Jason Keller, David Green, Randy LaJoy, those are the names that popped up the most in the garage area this morning when I asked to pick a favorite.
That's for sure. You know, these guys were the ones that looked really good last night in happy hour. But one thing to remember, last night in happy hour, when happy hour concluded, it was dark, lights were on, much cooler, a whole different racetrack to deal with today.
And I think it'll be a lot of fun. Mike Bliss, Shane Meal, Todd Bodine pouring up through the pack at the green flag.
It'll be very exciting to watch them come from the back.
It is going to be a lot of cars going forward, some going backwards after the green flag drops. That's coming up in just a moment. That's going to do it for the Ramada Inn pre-race show. The start is next on FX. The NASCAR Busch Series on FX, presented by Subway. Race number 8 for the Busch Series about to get underway. $900,000 on the line today as 43 drivers will go after the lion's share. Let's go trackside for the invitation.
Ladies and gentlemen, we'd like to introduce you to some folks who are on stage with us.
in just a few moments with our national anthem, country music star Shelley Wright. We have with us today, as we did last night, proud to have the color guard from the United States Marine Corps, led by Staff Sergeant Dan Hutzel. And our invocation today will be given by Pastor Ken Huck to the Emmanuel Baptist Church here in Lebanon. Later on, a flyover from the 4th Squadron, 278th Armored Cavalry Regiment of the Tennessee National Guard. Ladies and gentlemen, if you would please join us and stand for our invocation. Remain standing for our national anthem with our invocation today, Pastor Ken Hucks. Pastor Hucks.
Pray with me. Father, thank you for your grace to be in this place. Protect us, be with the drivers, the crews, give them strength and courage. Thank you for our armed services serving around the world. Give them victory. As we pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red. Bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled
strong. They're about to get it on here at the Nashville Super Speedway. The Busch Series on FX, presented by Subway. Don't go away. The NASCAR Busch Series on FX, presented by Subway. You see the cars in the background now beginning to roll out onto the racetrack for the first of their pace laps. Now let's take a look at the McGuire starting grid. Randy LaJoie on the pole shares the front row with Jason Keller. Keller doesn't have a guitar. LaJoie does, would like a second one. Kevin Grubb, the big surprise in qualifying in third. Hornaday looked pretty racy at the end of happy hour. He may have something for them today. David Stremme, first Busch Series start. at those who did not qualify for the Pepsi 300. Dion Cicerelli, Joe Buford, Jeff Streeter, Norm Benning, John Hayden, and Gus Wasson, who hit the wall in qualifying. Here's a look at some of the guys who are going to be carrying in-car cameras today. Scott Wimmer, the Stacker 2 machine. Ernie Sadler, the Toys R Us Chevrolet, the Autism Ribbon machine as well. View. He's number one. He's got the tail gunner camera. Everybody behind him. He'd like that shot all day long.
He'd like us to take a look at everybody behind him.
And you see Stanton Barrett's crew starting to get ready, get warmed up, suited up. The tire rules, three sets of tires.
Tire management. You know, these guys want to pick the right time to put those tires under caution, as many as you need under green flag stops, but only three sets during cautions.
Pit road speed.
45 miles an hour. Tight pits. These pits are very tight.
We're getting set to go here at the Nashville Super Speedway. Race 8 is about to get underway. Brett, we know what Darrell says. What have you got to say here as they slowly make their way towards the start-finish line?
Mr. Starter, drop that green rag. Let's go racing.
That was colorful. We're underway. The Nashville Super Speedway. Randy LaJoy, slight advantage on the bottom of the racetrack. You see Jason Keller trying to fight to the bottom of the racetrack, but his teammate Scott Riggs in that yellow car won't let him get there.
Didn't want any part of letting the teammate in. You fall in behind me, sir.
So Randy LaJoy is going to lead lap number one. He hasn't led a lap all season. As a matter of fact, hasn't led a lap since July of last year at Daytona. So that monkey's off the bench.
And he'd like to lead a bunch of them today.
See LaJoy now picking up a little bit of a gap on second place Scott Riggs. His rearview mirror full of teammate Jason Keller.
Everybody battling, trying to get to that inside lane. They want the bottom of the racetrack. Feel what their car's doing. Let the race settle in. Let the racetrack come to them.
From Jason Keller's machine as he chases down Scott Riggs. Looks like about a two-car length advantage as they climb to the bottom of the racetrack in turn one. Now working their way out of turn number two. And you can see how they come very close to the wall. Here's Brian Vickers, good side-by-side battle there with David Rudiman. Rudiman driving the Joe Nemechek on machine.
That's for the 14th place position. Vickers trying to keep Rudiman up on that outside so he can make a move on the inside. Looks like he's gonna pull it off coming off of four. Rudiman got a little bit sideways, a little bit squirrely. Chase Montgomery jumped right in that hole also.
And now Ruderman tries to drop down to the bottom of the racetrack and cut off Scott Wimmer. Looks like he did it. That's the view from Wimmer as Ruderman barely got back in line.
That's called slamming the door.
On your foot. On the other guy's foot. Scott Wimmer currently in the 17th position. He was as hot as anybody could be at the end of last season, but has struggled at the opening of 2003. Wimmer's got a long way to go in this race to get up front. Plenty of time to get there. And again, leader Randy LaJoie trying to stretch away from Scott Riggs and Jason Keller. And they're stretching away right now from the man currently riding in that fourth spot, the surprising Kevin Krupp.
Stacy Compton making a move on the bottom side of the racetrack. That's where we're going to see that passing all day. And it's very easy to run out of racetrack coming up out of turn four.
That looked mighty close. They're back in one. On the outside, Kerry Earnhardt now sliding, trying to get up in front of him. Stacy Compton, they're still locked side by side. Ashton Lewis behind them. Brian Vickers in the draft of Lewis.
Kerry drove it down in there trying to keep him back there, but just couldn't quite get enough room to pull down in front of him. Stacy said, man, I don't want you down in here. I want to get back in front of you as we go to turn one.
Kerry using up a lot of race car right now, trying to hang out there.
Well, he's running hard. He just wants that track position, wants to maintain it. He just doesn't want to give up any positions. He doesn't have to, but they got him trapped on the outside.
Ashton Lewis got by. Now Brian Vickers trying to make a move on that Janet King Chevrolet.
Whoa, and Vickers.
He's out of shape.
Great decision. Awesome decision by Brian Vickers right there. Knew he was going to lose it and just said, let me lock it down and get it in the infield grass where it's safe. No caution yet. No caution flag on the speedway. Vickers trying to get out of the infield, spinning his tires in that grass. He's going to make it out before Randy LaJoie comes around off of turn four to lap him. But
here's another look at what happened to Brian Vickers. He's down low, trying to squeeze underneath Kerry Earnhardt.
Kerry's holding him tight. And, these guys got these cars freed up for the long run. Car's a little bit free early on in a run. Car just got out from underneath him. Just trying to make the pass and couldn't get the bite on the bottom side of the racetrack.
Here's another look, and just for a split second, Brian Vickers thought, maybe I'm going to catch this, and like yesterday, Mike Bliss tried and wrecked. This time he said, I'm just going to lock it down and hang left.
Very smart decision. Just lock it down, get in the grass. Nice big infield area to save this race car.
Brian Vickers now running 43rd, dead last in this event, and about half a straightaway in front of the leader right there, Randy LaJoie, who's beginning to get away from Scott Riggs here just a bit in the early going, working just the 10th lap, about to complete it here in this race. LaJoie looking very strong early on. That car really hooked up as these cars continue to fly around the Nashville Super Speedway. Let's go down to Bill Venturini. Bill?
Yeah, well, we were just listening to the crew for Todd Vickers, and we heard what they said to him. Said, take some deep breaths. You're fine. But make sure you clean your tires before you get going again.
And Brian Vickers right now would surely love to see a yellow flag. The distance between him and leader Randy LaJoie has remained fairly constant. But he's got a whole racetrack to make up on the lead machine after that incident in turn four. LaJoie, the pole sitter, has led every single lap so far here at the Nashville Super Speedway. Scott Riggs is giving chase. Hey, NASCAR fans, you still have a chance to be the official Grand Marshal at a 2004 Winston Cup race. It's the Be a NASCAR Grand Marshal for a Day contest. Tune into the first hour after the green flag drops for each of Fox's or FX 2003 Winston Cup races. Look for the secret number on the animated car, then log on to NASCAR.com or FoxSports.com on Lycos and enter this number for your chance to win. The Be a NASCAR Grand Marshal for a Day contest continues tomorrow on Fox. There's your leader, the pole sitter, Randy LaJoie. He has led every single circuit and right now has opened up about four or five car lengths on Scott Riggs.
Bobby Hamilton Jr. running strong. He's up to fifth. We got an update from Glenn Jarrett.
Yeah, Mark, I went up to Fred Wanky, his crew chief, and I asked him how Bobby liked the car. He said, I don't know. He said he hadn't said a word. He must like it, though. He's catching the leaders. I've been watching the scoreboard, the leaderboard, the lap times from NASCAR the past six or eight laps, and Bobby Hamilton Jr. definitely has been the fastest car. Also, to add to that, Brian Vickers, even though he spun, has started putting some distance between he and leader Randy LaJoie. So Vickers, even after the spin, is running laps quicker than LaJoie was.
He's probably embarrassed, and he's also probably mad that he didn't get a yellow flag. Let's take a look from the in-car camera of Scott Wimmer of the Brian Vickers spin.
The back end just started to walk out on him. He was trying to pass Kerry Earnhardt there off of four and, you know, just lost the back end. Did the smart thing, locked it down, got it in the infield. He's got a race car to race with right now, and it's an awfully fast race car as he's pulling away from the leader.
Scott Wimmer burped the gas just a bit, then got back on the hammer, and by Vickers, there's your leader again, Randy LaJoie. And we mentioned at the beginning of the program a number of very good cars starting in the back of the pack for various reasons. One of those is Shane Meal, the Goulds Pump Chevrolet. Shane has picked up some 18 spots up to the 20th position right now and has done a great job of just chomping his way through the traffic. Right behind him is Mike Bliss and then Todd Bodine. So three very good cars have made up a lot of ground early, but Brett's, they've gotten by the easy stuff. Now it's going to get a little harder to make your way up to the pack.
They've done a great job. They've been working together, been very patient, you know, letting each other get through the traffic. Kind of Shane Meal's been the lead dog here, lead point man. He's been busting the holes open, and these other two guys have been following him through. But as you said, they're going to start getting into the faster, stronger race cars here, and it's going to get harder and harder for them to make it up through there.
Todd Bodine, the point leader of the Busch Series, coming into this race. And here's Bobby Hamilton now challenging Jason Keller for third. He's right there on the back bumper of the Albertsons Ford.
Well, these guys are working lap traffic. Right now, Jason's trying to get underneath the zero car. And, you know, how you work this lap traffic is going to determine how well you get up through the field. And Bobby Hamilton, his car made an awesome cut to the bottom of the racetrack. Drove right underneath Jason Keller coming off of turn four.
Jason could have made it three wide. Now we have trouble. Chase Montgomery is in the wall in turn four, and that will bring out the first yellow flag. Good news for Brian Vickers, and now more trouble. Steve Grissom is now involved, and we see another car spinning down through there, and that's Chris Bingham. A lot of damage to the back end of that car. And Regan Smith, his buffalo nose is kind of punched in right there. So, or is that Lipscomb University? That's Brad Baker.
Yeah, that's Brad Baker's car. He made it to pit road with a lot of damage to the front of that car.
And a lot of oil has been laid down on the racetrack. We also saw a little bit of a fire from the back of Steve Grissom's car, but it is out. We see some debris there as those cars slowly make their way by to take the caution flag. It is the first one of the afternoon. There's the man who touched off that multi-car melee, Chase Montgomery. Here's another look at that wreck.
Oh, I think we got an engine problem. That's Chase Montgomery's smoke prior to starting to spin, then the tire smoke. Yeah, smoke coming out of the tailpipes there as he's backwards against the wall. And that's really what caused the second part. These guys got in the oil, the 49 car. He slid in the oil, got up into the outside wall. And very fortunate, the leaders just got by there, Randy LaJoie, Scott Riggs. There's Bobby Hamilton Jr. He's doing all he can do to avoid the accident. And here comes the leaders down pit road.
First yellow, first pit stop of the day. Again, they can change three sets of tires under caution. Randy LaJoie slowly making his way down pit road at 45 miles per hour. Let's go to Bill Venturini first.
Yeah, we're down here in the 10 pit, and they're changing four tires right now. Right sides are off, going to the left side. Nope, they decided only two.
Now to Glenn Jarrett.
And Randy LaJoie, the leader, comes in as well. Behind him, David Green, Bobby Hamilton Jr. They're going to change four tires on LaJoie's car. He was starting to lose the nose just a little bit. The lap times were falling off. Scott Riggs goes by, but LaJoie's still in there on the left side now. Jason Keller goes by. A little bit of trouble on the left side tires. LaJoie is down and away. He will come out at least fourth of the car. cars that pitted.
Scott Riggs will lead them off pit road, followed by teammate Jason Keller, then David Green, and Randy LaJoy went in first, and he will come out fourth here on lap 24 at the Nashville Super Speedway. More of the Busch Series on FX presented by Subway when we return. The NASCAR Busch Series on FX presented by Subway here at the Nashville Super Speedway. Subway sandwich would go good right about now. It's been a pretty long day. Here's the McGuire's trivia question of the day. How many of the three NASCAR Busch Series races at Nashville were won by first-time Busch Series winners?
I know that.
No, you don't.
Yeah, I do.
You're a driver. You don't know factual information like that.
You're right, but I do know that one.
Well, and you know why? Because I gave you the answer already, right? I gave you the notes to read.
Listen to you.
All right, how many?
Take
how many?
All the credit.
How many?
All three.
You're absolutely right. Three first-time winners here at Nashville. Will we get a fourth today? That's the big question. The track cleanup continues after that multi-car wreck. So we'll come back to Nashville Super Speedway right after this. Tuesday's FX rolls out a new outrageous original series by Big Fat Greek Wedding's John Corbett is lucky. The odds just keep getting odder. Lucky, a new original series Tuesdays at 10 p.m. Eastern only on FX. Getting set to go back to green flag racing after our first caution flag. Shane Hall inherited the lead for a few laps, but he and Brad Teague have now pitted, and that will put Scott Riggs on the point, followed by David Green and then Randy LaJoy. On the inside lane, down a lap already, Hermie Sadler, that's the Toys R Us Autism Chevrolet. Gets a good jump. He goes to the outside of Sadler. David Green had an idea. Let's make it three wide. I'll go to the bottom, but he decided against it and now swings back to the high side of Sadler's machine as they work out of turn two.
Well, we're going to find out real quick here. Two tires versus four tires. The 10 car took two tires and the 7 took all four. We'll see how it plays out. See what it takes to stay competitive and keep that track position. That's why these guys make these decisions, try to keep that track position.
And why the crew chiefs get paid the big bucks. And
there you go.
Why their heads are usually the first ones on the platter when things don't go right. Scott Riggs getting a lot of pressure from David Green. Ford against Pontiac up front early on here at Nashville. Jason Keller had to make an extra pit stop under yellow. Glenn Jarrett has the update.
Yeah, Mark, they only changed two tires. They came in for a right side tire change, just like his teammate Scott Riggs. But for some reason, they didn't get all the fuel in the car. I'm actually on my way up there to talk to Steve Addington, the crew chief, to find out why not, because they had only run 24 laps under green. So I don't really understand why that happened. But Jason Keller did have to come back in and top off with fuel. I'll try to get a little further update on the story. And now let's go to Bill Venturini.
Well, the number 60 car, Stan Barrett, you know, he complained earlier that he was tight in the center and loose off. He came in, he got four tires, no chassis change, no pressure change. The crew told him, just change your line if you have to.
On the racetrack now, Barrett running in the 18th position and sliding back. He's been drafted by on the inside like it was the talent.
Whoa, we got trouble in turn two.
And it looks to be Todd Bodine, all kinds of out of shape, might have gotten the wall just a little bit. We'll have to see if there's any damage to the right side of that Herzog Jackson Chevrolet.
Todd did a great job saving that car. He got in there on the outside and it just got away from him, slid up into the marbles and did not hit the wall, but he has lost a tremendous amount of track position.
Randy LaJoy got past David Green for second. Now he is making an assault on the number one spot way down to the bottom of the racetrack. Green almost made it three wide. This is the battle for the lead. LaJoy again back to the point, and Riggs trying to slam the inside door on David Green.
Looks like those four tires are paying off right now for Randy LaJoy. Scott Riggs is wishing he had four tires.
Bobby Hamilton right there also looking very racy. I believe Hamilton took on, we'll have to update that. Stacy Compton's in car, drafting by Scott Riggs in that bright yellow Nesquik machine. Here's a look at Todd Bodine. High, wide, and handsome out there in the corner. A nice save.
Look at that dust flying up in the marbles, the dust debris off these tires. That was close.
You know, at that point, you have to say, look, you have to back out of the gas or that's it. Good battle here for fourth. Scott Riggs, two tires, not the recipe. Scott Wimmer now looks to his inside. David Rudiman right there behind him in the Joe Dunacek car. And there's a shot we've seen a lot the last few laps. An in-car camera blowing by to the inside of Scott Riggs.
Yeah, right now I'm sure these guys are questioning that two-tire call on the Ted car. But
they're lining up on him right now. Here's Rudiman. Right behind him, Ashton Lewis. Scott Riggs is going to go back, and he's going to continue to drop back like he threw out an anchor. Out the back, Scott Wimmer's Stamina RX machine. There you see Randy LaJoy. David Green has taken over the number two spot. Bobby Hamilton Jr., that bright red Team Marine Ford, trying to march its way to the front. A year ago, he had a chance to win both races here at Nashville, came up empty. He only lives about 8 miles from this racetrack, and one of seven drivers from Tennessee that came here this weekend looking for some home state bragging rights.
Talked to Fred Wanky this morning about their chances, crew chief of the 25 car for Bobby Hamilton Jr., and Fred was very confident in what they had, the package they had underneath the car. Was just raving about that Robert Yates horsepower under the hood. Said that thing was a real hoss and was making that car go down the straightaway and handle real well.
And when you handle down the straightaways, that's a load pretty well. You don't have to hurt your car so much in the corners or work so hard.
The driver likes it when it's handling down the straightaway.
And you see creeping into the picture, Stacy Compton running in the fourth spot. And of course, that driver from Gritt, Virginia, you see out the front of his car right now. Looks like he is trying to track down the lead machines. He's getting ever closer. Scott Riggs had problems a lap ago. Let's take a look what happened to him. Casey Kane's right there.
Just a little bit of a love tap saying, I'm still here.
A little how do you do, and that, of course, opened up the inside lane. Two or three more cars got by Scott Riggs. He has now dropped back to the 15th position. And on this restart, he was number one. There you see David Stremme fighting with Coy Gibbs right there. That is a battle for the 12th spot. And again, a picture of Scott Riggs mired in heavy traffic. Randy LaJoy is the leader for the second time today. David Green is trying to keep him in sight with Bobby Hamilton running third. On a gorgeous day in Tennessee, we're back with more of the NASCAR Busch Series on FX, presented by Subway. Randy LaJoy, the pole sitter. This is the second time this afternoon he's been out front, but the first time he's had David Green gnawing on his back bumper.
That Timberwolf Pontiac has really gotten hooked up. He's chased him down. Bobby Hamilton Jr., just a couple car lengths back. He's doing a great job chasing down that leader also.
You think the crew chiefs know what's going on this morning? Those three guys are three of the top five they brought up who could win the race. So perhaps they know what they're talking about. Here's David Green closing in on that Kleenex Chevrolet of Randy LaJoy. We mentioned that before the break, Scott Riggs was having some problems. Bill Venturini has more on that story.
I'm with Scott Riggs crew chief Doug Randolph. Doug, Scott seems to be dropping back. Has he said anything about what's happening?
No, the Nesquik Taurus is running good today. We just sort of got freight trained on the inside there. There's not much grip in that outside groove yet, so we just had to take our legs, fall to the back until we can get back in line. He's picking them off one at a time now. A lot of racing left. We'll be in fine shape.
Okay, thanks a lot. Down to you, Glenn.
Well, another car that we need to keep an eye on is that number 20 of Mike Bliss. He has worked his way up into the ninth position right now. He has, in the last few laps, been one of the quicker cars on the track. Remember, Bliss wrecked his primary car in qualifying yesterday. Then after happy hour, had to change an engine. So he started in the rear of the field all the way up to the top 10. He's going to be good before this thing's over. Also, let's put a period on the Jason Keller story. I told you I didn't understand why he didn't get the gas in the car. Normally, when they come in, there was miscommunication. When they come in, gas man makes the wedge adjustment on the left rear of the car. He did that thinking they were going to change four tires. He goes over and makes the adjustment first, before they put the gas in the car. By the time he got the adjustment in, the right side tires were changed. Jason was down and away, so they didn't get any gas in the car until he came back in the second time.
Jason Keller now running in the 20th position. He's been able to make up a number of spots since that issue after the caution flag and the ensuing restart. Back up front, Randy LaJoy, still a mirror full of David Green, and back there looming in the third spot, Bobby Hamilton Jr.
You know, David Green chased him down quite easy, but you know, he's caught him, but he can't do anything with him. You know, a little bit of that aero push that we like to talk about when a car gets up behind it, another car catches him, chases him down, but then he loses the air off the front of his car, can't get it to turn. You can see right there, it looked like David Green pushed up a little bit as he came off of turn four.
Very hard. What can you tell us about David Green?
You know, Mark, it's pretty odd that Brent is sitting up there in the pits, and he said exactly what I was going to, or sitting up there in the booth, and said exactly what I was going to say. They made significant changes on David's car when he came in for that pit stop a while ago. They changed two right side tires and made several chassis adjustments on the car, and the problem was he had a big aero push, so they were trying to free the car up a little bit. They got it freed up enough for him to get to LaJoy, but now he has picked up that aero push, and Brent, man, you're all over it. Good job.
When Jarrett, Brett Bodine, thinking a lot like two Siamese twins, thinking like, that's scary.
Yeah, it is scary. Very scary.
Now they're getting into some heavy traffic. Let's see if David Green can use some of this to his advantage. They're coming up on the Ron Young machine. LaJoy slides to his outside. David Green will follow him through. Jason White in the white number zero just up ahead. Double wide racing. There's Bobby Hamilton. He said, well, if you guys got to check up for the slower cars, I'm going to make up some ground here.
Just kind of keeping them honest. You know, lap car might slip, make you run a little higher than you want to and leave the bottom open.
I watched a year ago at Memphis where Greg Biffle had a race pretty well locked up. It was taken out by a lap car. Randy LaJoy, though, gets by safely. We're still early here at Nashville. We continue from the Nashville Super Speedway with NASCAR Busch Series action on FX presented by Subway. It's getting red hot up front. David Green has finally worked his way to the inside of Green leader Randy LaJoy.
David has been working and working on the back of that car. Randy LaJoy is trying to get him just loose enough to move him up out of that low groove. He's there, but can he pull it off?
Oh, they get close. They might have touched just a bit past the start-finish line. Bobby Hamilton is basically back there saying, hey, you guys are having some fun. I think I'd like to join the party. And again, Green almost gets into LaJoy.
See what's happened here. Randy's on the outside, and he's holding David down. David can't let his car run up the racetrack as they come up out of the corner. Let it have its the nose, let it have its head coming up out. He's got to hold it down, and he can't get in the throttle now because Randy's on the outside of it.
Again, a squeeze play as they rocket past the start-finish line to turn number one.
Boy, Randy's driving it down in the corner. I'll tell you that right now. He wants to hold on to it. David got by.
A slide job, and now LaJoy jumps to the inside and tries to retake the lead down the back straightaway. It doesn't look like he can do it, but they're coming up on a slower car. That's Jeff Fuller in a car owned by Stanton Barrett. Randy was trying to get close enough to give him a little love tap, and now here's three wide. The lap car on the outside, LaJoy and Hamilton split Fuller, and Hamilton Jr. makes the pass in the Team Marine Ford.
Well, we talked earlier, Mark, about David Green's ability to chase down Randy LaJoy, but struggle to get by him. David Green's got open sailing, clear racetrack ahead of him. Let's see if he can pull away.
And we'll have to see how strong Bobby Hamilton Jr. is now that he has gotten by LaJoy. See if he can make up the ground on the leader. And speaking of Bobby Hamilton Jr. in his pits, Glenn Jarrett.
Well, we've been listening to their radio communication between Bobby Jr. and his crew chief, Fred Wanky, guys. And Bobby's been reporting the car is just a little bit tight in the center of the corner. But other than that, he's fine. He liked that battle going on there because it allowed him to close up and get by. Let's go to Bill Venturini.
Well, the 87 car, David Ruderman, he started 16th. They made some pit stops, pulled a half a rubber to right rear, and because he said the car was loose, put right side tires on only. He's running fifth right now, but his radio, his crew just asked him, how did the last pit stop help? He said, yeah, it helped, but it's going back to where it was. They just told him, you're the fastest car on the racetrack. Keep digging.
A great story, David Ruderman, driving for Joe Nemechek, 32 years old, Florida native, part of a very big racing clan up in our old neck of the woods, Brett Bodine.
Buzzy Ruderman driving the 00 Dover brake car. What a legend in dirt track racing.
Let's go back to the front of the pack where David Green, the first time today, he has been out front, but he's got some company. Bobby Hamilton Jr. trying to take the top spot away. Tracks him down in turn two. Looks like Hamilton Jr. right now getting a little bit of a better run up out of the corners than David Green. They're both running fast, but it looks like Hamilton Jr. just maybe a tick better.
Bobby's looking really good, as you said, right in the center of the corner. Runs up on the outside of the lap car there, Brad Teague.
There they flash by. David Green completing the 64th lap, and Bobby Hamilton Jr. noses down to the inside, can't get it done. They're single file again, as they work the 14 degrees of banking in corners one and two here at Nashville. Tight draft down the back straightaway. Hamilton Jr. trying to get maybe close enough to loosen him up. And here's David Ruderman now moving up a spot. He'll move by Stacy Compton and take over the number four spot. Here's Hamilton Jr. now. He will lead this race. Into turn number one, we have trouble, and that is Scott Wimmer involved there. That'll bring out the second caution flag. Here's the lead machines now trying to slow down with a yellow flag waving, working their way down the back straightaway. That action, they'll come upon it now. They'll move by it as they work their way through turns three and four. Justin Ashburn and Scott Wimmer got involved there. You see those two crippled cars lying down to the inside of the racetrack. Wimmer finally refires that battered Stacker 2 car and is trying to move back in the right direction. Bobby Hamilton Jr. leads them across the start-finish line and the second yellow flag inside Scott Wimmer's car. To go backwards,
you can't go forward. Something there he goes. He's got it going in the right direction now, but heavy damage to both of those cars.
You see the in-car camera a moment ago. Now you hear the in-car audio, the scratching and the scraping and the scrunching inside that car. Those are noises the driver never likes to.
That's for sure. Three cars involved in that wreck. We saw Kerry Earnhardt. He kind of split the goalpost. He went between the two cars as they were sliding down the racetrack, and he did a great job of avoiding heavy contact.
Justin Ashburn, a lot of damage to his car. Here's a look from Scott Wimmer's in-car camera going into turn three. Looked like his car might have got nudged just a bit.
Hard impact into that outside wall.
The sounds from inside that car, unbelievable. The lead machines will get another opportunity to come to pit road. You see the yellow car blasting in first. That's Scott Riggs. Let's go to Bill Venturini.
We're in the pits of Mike Bliss right now. They're taking out four tires, and they went down on a half of a turn on the track bar. Left side tires are going on now. Let's go to Glenn.
And Bobby Hamilton, the leader, has come in. He's pitted right behind David Green, who is in second place. This will be a battle of the pit crews. Both teams are going for four tire changes. After seeing what happened to Scott Riggs, I don't think anybody wants to risk two tires right now. Hamilton, great pit stop. He's down and away. Beats Mike Bliss, Randy LaJoy, and David Green out of the pits.
And right behind them, it looks like it is going to be Stacy Compton and then Todd Bodine. We're under the second yellow flag here at the Nashville Super Speedway. Lap 67 has just been completed. We'll be back in a moment. It's all sunshine in Tennessee as NASCAR's Busch Series on FX presented by Subway early on here at the Nashville Super Speedway. Here's a race summary. 5 leaders, 7 lead changes, average speed 153.47 miles per hour, 28 cars still on the lead lap. 2 cautions now for 9 laps and counting.
Oh.
NASCAR on FX is brought to you by Smooth Bush Beer and easy drinking Bush Light. Head for the mountains of Bush. We're about to restart this race at the Nashville Super Speedway. 155 laps to go. Bobby Hamilton Jr. is your leader. Mike Bliss in the number 20 is your number two car. Then it's Randy LaJoy, and coming back into the picture there in the fourth spot, it's David Green. Then Stacy Compton, Todd Bodine right behind him, and then Brian Vickers. Ron Young, the first car on the inside line, the laps down machines. And the yellow flag is back out on lap number 71.
Bobby Jr. got a great jump on that restart. Hit by Ron Young going down to turn one. Mike Bliss, Randy LaJoy now battling for second spot.
And you can see what that lap traffic has meant for Bobby Hamilton Jr. Mike Bliss trying to break free and finally does clear Ron Young's machine. Randy LaJoy does the same thing, and now they will give pursuit to Bobby Hamilton Jr. Let's go down to Bill Venturini. He's standing by with the man who calls the shots for Mike Bliss.
Yeah, I'm with Mike Bliss' crew chief, Tim Shutt. You were fast off the trailer, had to go to backup car because you wrecked. Now you're running second. What's he saying?
Well, right now, Rockwell Automation Chevrolet is running really good. God's just blessed his team this weekend. Had some trials and tribulations the first part of the weekend, but all that hard work's paying off for right now. Mike says the car is still a little bit tight, but we had a really good pit stop, so we're looking forward to what the rest of the day has to bring.
Okay, let's go to Glenn for some other updates.
Okay, we got a little caution on the racetrack right now, but let's give an update on what happened to the leaders on that last pit. Bobby Hamilton came in, still complaining the car was a little bit tight. They adjusted that with tape on the nose of the car. Randy LaJoy was sliding the nose still. They put on four and made an air pressure adjustment. And the 37 car of David Green put on four tires and took a spring rubber out of the left rear. So that's the update on the three lead cars down at this end. Mark?
This is yellow flag number three. It was for Larry Gunselman, and you can see why. Backed into the wall. A lot of heavy damage to the back of that machine. He'll have to probably take it behind pit wall. Under the yellow, Bobby Hamilton Jr., though, continues to lead. Frozen in the second spot is Mike Bliss. The NASCAR Busch Series on FX presented by Subway back at the Nashville Super Speedway as we work the third caution flag of the day. We're about to restart this event here in just a moment. Bobby Hamilton Jr., your leader, Mike Bliss right there. It's been a rocky weekend for Bliss, but he's trying to atone for his qualifying mistake with a win today.
That team's done a great job getting him some track position here. Yeah, let's see if he can maintain it, keep it up towards the front. They had a tough start to the weekend, but they're doing a great job right now getting that car back in contention.
Last year at the Nashville Super Speedway for the Craftsman Truck Series event, Bliss won the pole and then won the race on his way to the championship. So he knows success here on this concrete 1.33-mile racetrack. Well, besides the restart, it's time to crank it up, folks. If you got a great stereo, you got some surround sound, turn it up. Get it wide open as we take the green flag here at Nashville. Just love all that all-American horsepower.
Sounds great to me.
I even turned up my headphones.
I wish
fun.
I was in one of those cars sitting behind it, though, pushing the loud pedal.
These drivers are just such lousy spectators. Bobby Hamilton Jr. is out front, starting to pull away from Mike Bliss. Last July, Hamilton Jr. led 35 laps and finished third. bit of a tire situation developing now again, as we said at the top of the broadcast, as NASCAR normally does for the Busch Series. On the super speedways, you have three sets of tires you can change under yellow. And Glenn Jarrett, right now, a couple of teams may be at a deficit when this race gets down to crunch time.
You're exactly right, Mark. The three top cars, the 25 of Bobby Hamlin Jr., the 20 of Mike Bliss, and the 7 of Randy LaJoie, on the two previous pit stops under caution, have already changed four tires each time. So if it comes down to where they have a late caution, they've only got one more set of tires. Now, obviously, if it's a late caution, that one set will do it. But if they have a lot of cautions between now and then, they only got one more set of tires they can change under caution. It may not come into play, but it could be something to keep our eye on. On the other end of the spectrum, the number 5 car, Brian Vickers, who spun earlier, he has only changed one set of tires under caution, so he's got two fresh sets left. That may be a big factor in this race before the day is over.
Brett, why would they use two sets so early?
That's a good question. No one have only got three under caution. They're definitely at a disadvantage right now. They've got to really play a smart game. They got to hope we have a lot of long green flag runs.
We haven't had that yet.
No, we've not seen it yet, but that's what they're banking on. They need some long green flag runs so they don't have to depend on that yellow flag tire situation.
Glenn, what can you add to the Bobby Hamilton issue when it comes to tires?
Well, Ed Rinsey came over, the team owner came over and told me that he heard what I was saying. He said the reason that they changed that, and I'll get my cameraman to show it here, guys. They picked up a screw or a nail or something off the racetrack. That was from the first set of tires, or they would have never have changed that first set. So you see right there is the reason that Bobby Hamilton is one set short right now.
That's a bad break.
That's a good reason to take it off.
Yeah.
Tires definitely need air in them to work correctly.
Maybe a little bit out of balance going the chugga-chugga over the nail or the screw that's set in that tire. Bobby Hamilton Jr. continues to lead. Continues to pull away here at his home track, the Nashville Super Speedway. More of the Busch Series on FX, presented by Subway, when we come back. The NASCAR Busch Series on FX, presented by Subway. Lap 87 of 225 complete here at the Nashville Super Speedway. There's Scott Riggs. He's currently in the 8th spot. They drop kicked that white car behind them. Him and Jason Keller back 2 spots. Keller has moved up to 9th. And now Todd Bodine is in that 10th position with Ashton Lewis Jr. closing in on him in that Civil Air Patrol Chevrolet.
Todd's running a 10th spot right now. As you said, he just got passed by Scott Riggs and Jason Keller. Looks like he's got a little bit of push in the car. Couldn't keep it on the bottom of the racetrack right there. You see him running that second lane or lane and a half up.
There's the Subway bumper cam from Jason Keller. Here's the battle for 5th. Stacy Compton has it. Young Mr. Brian Vickers would like to take it away.
Stacy Compton and that crew, they've got a great race car there today, really running well. And of course, Brian Vickers, we saw how strong he was after he spun out and was able to pull away from the leader at that time.
Brian Vickers again closes in. The back end of Stacy Compton's car kicks out, nearly collects the wall. Here now is the battle for 10th. Ashton Lewis powers to the inside of Todd Bodine. And there's Coy Gibbs creeping into the picture. Gibbs, the top finishing rookie, 4 times out of the first 7 races in that MBNA machine. And he is a guy, I think, that's just going to get better and better and better as the season progresses. He's impressed me the last few weeks.
No question about it, Mark. Coy and that team have really come together well. He's doing a great job as a race car driver, maturing very well.
2 straight top 10s, Talladega and Texas. A couple of pretty tough racetracks to get it done. Ashton Lewis Jr. can't quite fight his way past Todd Bodine. And that leaves Coy Gibbs and now Casey Kane with no running room, and Kane lines up behind Gibbs.
You know what looks good about that picture? Side-by-side racing here in Nashville. Todd's working that outside lane. That's good news. That's really good stuff for this racetrack.
Gibbs has decided he'll join the Civil Air Patrol car of Ashton Lewis Jr. at the bottom of the racetrack, trying to help him draft by. And Casey Kane gets an even better run up out of the corner. He goes to the inside of Coy Gibbs as we go down to pit road and Bill Venturini.
Yeah, I'm here with Tony Liberati, crew chief for Mr. Bodine here. Earlier, he almost hit the wall. It seems like it took him a little while to settle down. What's he saying now? Looks like he's doing all right.
Well, we started there, and we've come in and put tires on early right now. You can see that's what's going on. That's what's wrong right now. He got a little bit impatient, but we settled him down, and he's doing a heck of a job starting from the back. Looks like we're going to have to short pit him there a little bit and get some tires on that thing and try to get back in this.
Oh, a little strategy, short pitting him on that, huh?
Well, I didn't have no choice. We had to work on a car. We had to do a big air pressure change, and we did it on the tires we put on with the tire roll. It makes it pretty tough, but I know Chevrolet Monte Carlo is running pretty good, and hopefully we'll short pit him and it'll stay green for a while. We won't lose too much.
Thanks a lot. Up to the booth.
Well, if there's a guy who could maybe calm Todd Bodine just a bit, maybe somebody nicknamed Rambo has a shot.
A little bit of strategy there. Sounds like they didn't put tires on the last yellow, and trying to make sure that they do have tires for the end of the race.
Ashton Lewis has worked by. Todd Bodine dropping him to 11th. Back up front as Bobby Hamilton Jr. continues to lead this race, continuing to look very strong, and it doesn't look like he's going to give up that top spot very easily. The NASCAR Busch Series on FX, presented by Subway, returns after this. As the NASCAR Busch Series on FX, presented by Subway, continues, fourth yellow flag is flying. It is for Stedman Marlin, and he has spun the Keystone Light Dodge, number 30. Didn't look like he did a whole lot of damage to that car, Brett, and a number of cars barely squeaked by to the inside. That could have been big.
Well, the leaders were closing in fast, and evidently they just didn't quite see it in time. And boy, there was some really quick maneuvering to get by Stedman as he was parked over there in turn three.
He'll come on to pit road.
And leave pit road.
The pit lane is open, and surprisingly, Bobby Hamilton Jr. comes in. We'll have to see if this is a fuel-only type of situation, because as we work lap 100, still 125 laps to go, and they have only one more set of tires to change under yellow. So Hamilton Jr. at 45 miles per hour leads the parade down pit road. And now you see him make a quick break to the left. Let's go to Glenn Jarrett.
And this will be fuel only. As we talked about, they don't have the tires to put in. Fuel only also for David Green in front of him. They've got Hamilton full, and David Green beats him out. Randy LaJoy may beat them both.
So three wide.
Fuel only down here, Bill Venturini.
The 92 car, Todd Bodine, he's taking on four, and they did a wedge change and air pressure. He was saying he was tight in the middle, and he's out.
And as they come off of pit road, it looks like they're going to be led by Bobby Hamilton Jr., David Green. Here's a look at the replay of the Stedman Marlin spin. There he is, he loops it. Nice easy spin. That brings out the fourth yellow flag. We're back to Nashville Super Speedway in just a moment. Full weekend of racing action continues later today with the Winston Cup practice on FX from Martinsville. Then tomorrow, back to Virginia, starting with NASCAR This Morning, presented by Smirnoff Ice Triple Black on Fox Sports Net, followed by the Winston Cup race on Fox as Bobby Labonte looks to defend his title on one of the most competitive tracks in NASCAR. NASCAR continues this weekend across the Fox networks. Let's go down to pit road and Glenn Jarrett.
Well, real quickly, Mark, before the restart, some interesting strategy there. The 38, the 19, the 58, and the 21 did not pit that time because it didn't get them inside their fuel window. There's a little over 123 laps left to go. They can't make it on one stop, so those guys decided to stay out. Interesting strategy. We'll see how it pans out.
Casey Kane, Chad Blunt, 1 and 2 in line on the outside on this restart. Regan Smith, the white number 22 in the laps down lane. Green flag is back out. Four laps under yellow. Casey Kane and Blunt both clear the lapped automobile of Smith.
Now this has all the makings to be an exciting, because you got guys up front here, didn't pit, no tires. You got guys right behind them, two tires, some with only fuel. And we got a group race.
right behind them that took four tires.
A little bit of everything. Is that what you're trying to tell me?
We've got a mixed bag of excitement on the way.
Maybe some cats all thrown into the same bag?
Has all the makings to being exciting.
Okay. He's looked into his crystal ball and predicts we may have something interesting coming up. Here's a battle for the lead. Chad Blunt looks inside of Casey Kane. Those two young drivers battle down the back straightaway into turn three. Kane will give way as we go down to Glen Jarrett.
Well, Brett, you know, let's add one more thing to that. This is the first time today that we've seen LaJoy and Franny LaJoy spins.
And he hits the wall hard in turn four. It's snap hooked in there, brings out the fifth caution flag. So one of the guys we thought could contend and perhaps win this race won't. Here's a look at Randy LaJoy's problem.
Going down into turn three. Looks like he turns down in the corner trying to get in behind Bobby Jr. And Mike Bliss was there. Couldn't quite see on that shot who it was that possibly made contact, or Randy turned it in there and the back end just came out from underneath him.
That was a big lick that LaJoy took. He will now try to nurse that car back to the garage area and make repairs and come back out to gather up a few more points. The NASCAR Busch Series on FX presented by Subway. We're at the Nashville Super Speedway. The NASCAR Busch Series on FX presented by Subway. We're working the fifth yellow flag of the day. Here's a look at the race summary to this point. 7 leaders, 9 lead changes, average speed up to 151.33 miles per hour, 24 cars on the lead lap, 5 cautions now for 20 laps. We've got about 10 cars out of the race so far. With a look from inside Hermie Sadler's in-car camera, we're back for more NASCAR Busch Series on FX presented by Subway. Let's go to Bill Venturini. He's in the garage with perhaps a very unhappy guy.
Well, Randy, from where I was at, I saw the car wheel. I couldn't tell what really happened. Let us know.
Got corner paneled by a lap car. This Kleenex Chevy was good. We had a good race car. Guys did a great job preparing a race car at the shop and got off the truck, and we were fast and got the pole. And we were very competitive here today. And there was a couple guys that had some very good race cars, and we were working on ours to get ours better in the long run. We had a very good car in the short run, and some guys had a little bit better car in the long run. We're working on it. We're getting it. We ain't even halfway yet. And I seen them split that lap car down the back stretch, and I didn't know if I wanted to go low or high. I said, I'm just going to ride in high. And lap car whistled it in there and pushed up and left rid of me, and around I went.
Well, Randy was definitely fast all weekend, but it made for a short day. Let's go to Glenn.
Okay, thanks, Bill. Down at this end, let's talk about Casey Kane. He was leading the race on that last restart before the caution. He got passed by Chad Blunt, and the reason he did, he had a right rear tire going down. Remember, he didn't change any tires. They stayed out on the racetrack, so the right rear was cut. Casey came in under this caution period. They changed right sides, which is their last set of right sides that they can change under caution. Then he came back down pit road because he was at the end of the field anyway, and the guys checked the left side tires. Everything's okay on the car right now. Let's go back up front to Bobby Hamilton, who's running fifth right now. On the last time he stopped, they put fuel in the car, and they also made a track bar adjustment to try to free the car up. They're hoping that things will settle down now, and they'll have a good long green flag run. His car tends to tighten up as they go on into a run, and so they're trying to free the car up to adjust for when it gets tighter later on. Brett, maybe you can expand on that a little bit about what they do with the track bar.
Well, the track bar raises or lowers the controls the rear roll center height. And by raising that track bar up, tries to make the back of the car turn better, rotate better through the center of the corner.
We're about to restart this race again here at the Nashville Super Speedway after the fifth caution flag of the day has been pulled in. The green flag's about to wave. That means we can crank it up. Get your surround sound. Full volume. I got my headsets turned up. We're going back to green. Chad Blunt continuing to lead here at the Nashville Super Speedway. Won four races a year ago on the ARCA Series, was their rookie of the year. And look at that behind him. That's a little scary, three wide going down into the corner. There is Blunt leading the way. There's that great battle behind him. Johnny Sauter, David Green, Martin Truex Jr., great driver from the Busch North Series, and right there again, marching to the front of the Team Marine Ford. That's Bobby Hamilton Jr. in the number 25.
Martin Truex Jr., he's a real up-and-coming driver from the Northeast, doing a great job today in his first trip here to Nashville Super Speedway.
Kerry Earnhardt in that big pack of traffic you're looking at now in the corners. It's a little bit jumbled up, lead lap cars and lap machines. And for an update on Kerry Earnhardt, let's go to Glenn Jarrett.
Well, guys, he is earning his paycheck today. They haven't had trouble with the car since the start of the race. It flies out of gear. They put a bungee cord on it to try to hold it in gear. It would not stay in. So right now, Kerry is driving with the left hand only, using the right hand to hold the car in gear.
Johnny Sauter trying to hold off Bobby Hamilton Jr. By the way, Brett, how hard is it to drive one-handed?
As Glenn said, he's earning his paycheck today. He's got to hold that thing in gear and drive one-handed. He's got his hand full.
So your right hand is on the shifter. It'll get a cramp at some point. Your left arm, bicep, and forearm are probably just going to be screaming for mommy a little bit later today.
Well, in trying to control the car and keep it in the groove and work the traffic, do all the things that you need to do under normal conditions, and then have to work twice as hard with that left hand driving, steering the car.
Here's Stacy Compton now with David Rudiman down on the bottom of the racetrack trying to get by Martin Truex Jr.
Now this is the part where we're talking about earlier. We got some guys with fresh tires starting to work their way up through these guys that only maybe changed two or none at all. That's what's making for the traffic jam.
Kerry Earnhardt now is down on the apron of the racetrack. Very slow. You see the Janna King, number 12, working its way towards pit lane. So the problem that Glenn Jarrett talked about maybe got a whole lot worse.
I'll bet you that transmission finally gave up.
Either that or his arms.
Well, I don't think Kerry's going to give up just because of his arm. But I believe that probably he's got some mechanical trouble with the 12.
Let's see if he goes to pit road or behind a pit wall. That's the telltale sign. Back up front, Chad Blunt. Chad Blunt continues to lead this race, but first let's go to Glenn Jarrett.
Brett, you're exactly right. The transmission finally did kill out of that car, so they're going to have to change it, get him back in, or just call it a day. But the transmission is gone in Kerry Earnhardt's car.
Again, Chad Blunt out front, 0.8 of a second of a lead over David Green. And Bill Venturini is with his car owner.
I'm with the car owner of the APV prepaid gas car, Todd Braun. Todd, I know Chad's used to running up front in the ARCA Series. This is the first time he's led in the Busch Series. And I heard you still have some tires left. Tell us what's going on.
Well, Bill, I don't know exactly what you said, but I heard you say something about ARCA. We were in the same situation here last year, and unfortunately we got taken out with about 10 to go, but we're pretty sure it's not going to happen to us this week. But we made the right call. We got four tires left here in the pits you have to put on under caution, and Chad's doing a heck of a job out there. He's just as fast as anybody once we get him out in clean air.
Well, this kid's not, he's familiar on what it's like to run up front here at Nashville.
He's running up front, and you see David Green creeping into that picture now as they work out of turn number two. He'll have a hard time holding off the Timberwolf Pontiac. But Chad Blunt doing a great job, his best finish so far this season, a fifth at Texas. He's another one of the young up-and-comers in NASCAR racing. There's no question he's got stardom in his future. David Green, the wily veteran, the former champion, working on trying to track him down.
David working that low lane down there. It looks like he's got his car turning a little better.
Green is there on the back bumper of Chad Blunt. How soon before he pulls the trigger? Gets through the center of the corner a lot better than Blunt that time, but Chad will lead him across the start-finish line, maintain the lead by a car length.
Looks like that Dodge horsepower is doing a job on the straightaway. He's able to open it up.
Glenn, I understand you have a question for Mr. Bodine.
Yes, I do, Mark. And the question is, Brett, I reported earlier on that David Green, they took a rubber out of the left rear spring. And just tell us what that does from a driver's standpoint, what the difference in the feel for the car is when you take a spring rear out of the left rubber.
Well, what they're trying...
rubber out of the left rear, excuse me.
There you go. What they're trying to do is take some bite, take some traction away from that left rear tire, make the rear of the car rotate through the center of the corner equally off of both rear tires. If the left rear is biting too much off the left side of the car, it'll drive the nose, push the nose of the car, make the car climb the hill with the front end, not be able to make the corner. By taking some of that spring rubber out of the left rear, just taking some traction away from that left rear tire and trying to make the car rotate the center of the corner better. Looks like they've accomplished that. But again, he's chased down Chad Blunt all over the back of his car, but he can't quite complete the pass. He's able to run very low through the center of the corner, but when he gets right up to the back of the car, probably takes that push again and unable to make the pass.
Instant replay of earlier in the race when David Green was chasing Randy LaJoy. After about 15, 20 laps, he finally wore him down, took the lead, and then drove away. But Chad Blunt right now trying to hold on to that top spot by his fingernails as we are nearing the halfway mark, just past the halfway mark here at the Nashville Super Speedway. NASCAR Busch Series on FX, presented by Subway. We're under 100 laps to go here at the Nashville Super Speedway with NASCAR Busch Series racing on FX, presented by Subway. Just like the movie Groundhog Day, when we last left you, the picture looked just like that. Chad Blunt with the lead, David Green getting there, but not able to get by.
David doing everything he can to try to keep his car on the bottom and get to the back bumper of Chad Blunt. Hopefully he could loosen him up or get his timing off and make a move, but he just has not been able to shake him. You got to really admire what Chad Blunt's been able to do here, holding on to this lead, fighting off this veteran, David Green.
Chad Blunt using Mike Harmon's car as a bit of a pick out of turn four to hold David Green off. Let's go down to Bill Venturini. He was the man that helped bring out the first caution flag a little bit earlier this afternoon.
Well, I'm with hometown favorite Chase Montgomery, who's got to be the most unluckiest guy here at Nashville Speedway. Last night, NASCAR race, you had problems. Tell us what happened today.
You know, we went off into turn three and lost the motor right before I lifted. Oh, got under the rear tires, and I was just holding on for the rod.
Well, talk about bad luck. What's with the arm? Are you okay?
Yeah, I'll be all right. We'll be back in California. It's possibly fractured, but we'll find out next week, and we'll be ready to go.
Back up to the booth.
Trouble for Casey Kane. You see his brake clips. Ford has clipped the wall and is headed in the wrong direction, and that'll bring out the yellow flag for the sixth time today. And you can see as he comes back around, a lot of damage to the left side, some damage also to the rear of that car. And Casey Kane, who was having a pretty solid run, looks like he's headed to the garage area for some major repairs if he is able to continue. Not a big lick, but enough.
Yeah, enough. He's going to have to go in the garage area. He gets to do some serious work to that race car. Just pancaked the left side of the car. Got up in the outside there and spun around.
Needs a little trim around the wheel wells, at least.
A little trim around the wheel wells.
A lot of smoke there here. Under yellow, Chad Blunt, the leader of this race, will lead them onto pit road, followed by David Green, 45 miles per hour, the pit road speed. David trying to make a pass. That's kind of interesting right there as they're working almost side by side down the pit lane. Stacy Compton behind those two. Let's go to Bill Venturini.
Hey, I'm in a 19 pit right now. They're taking on four tires, and it looks like they're going to do a track bar adjustment. Right side tires are going on right now. Car's getting filled with 20 gallons of 76 fuel. Let's go to Glenn Jarrett.
Well, down at this end, Bill, the 37 car of David Green has come in as well, and they're making a four-tire change. I haven't seen any chassis adjustments on the car, and the jackman was just a little late. He had a little problem getting around the car. They tear the windshield strip off. He stalls the car as he starts out, but he's got it refired, and Chad Blunt beats him out as well as the 46 car there. So four-tire change here. Remember, David Green was one of those cars that had actually a set and a half of tires left to change under caution. They took this opportunity to use one of them.
And it looks like Brian Vickers is going to lead them off pit road as we now look from the in-car camera of Stanton Barrett at the problems for Casey Kane.
Casey got down, the car was just yawed out getting down in there. He was loose getting into the corner, trying to save it, just turned around and slammed it.
Bobby Hamilton Jr. did not pit. He's the leader again here at the Nashville Super Speedway. More of the NASCAR Busch Series on FX presented by Subway coming up. As we return to the Nashville Super Speedway, the NASCAR Busch Series on FX presented by Subway about to get back underway as we close in on the finish of the eighth Busch Series race of 2003. Green flags back out. Again, Bobby Hamilton Jr. with a great jump. He flies past the lap traffic. Now Jay Sauter, Shane Beal, the cars running second and third, clear those cars as well.
Bobby Jr. has done a great job on those restarts when he's been in the lead, clearing that lap traffic in a hurry.
Just behind them, the fourth place car, Brian Vickers, is trying to hold off Jason Keller. Todd Bodine right there, the white car, number 92. Here's your top three. Shane Beal got awful close to that speed cam coming out of turn four.
Gave us a great view.
Yeah, the right rear corner came by about an inch away.
Shane looking on that outside lane. He's going to try the waters up there, test it out, see if he can make a move on Jay Sauter.
Shane Beal has been running pretty strong lately. And look at this pack of traffic. Make that three wide. David Green splitting a lap car. Chad Blunt to his outside. Now David Green will drop behind Blunt, go around the lap car of Ron Young. Let's go to Glenn Jarrett.
Well, Mark, some interesting pit strategy already starting to be played out down in David Green's pit. Even though he was up at the front of the pack there, his crew chief, Jason Ratcliffe, called him in. Jason, why did you decide to pit then?
Well, time and time again, we see this deal where guys middle of the pack back, take tires, and then stay out. And we know we got a good race car. David's doing a good job in Timberwolf Pontiac. If we can just be up front at the end of this deal, we feel like we can win it regardless of what how many laps the tires got on.
Well, he thinks that they can stay up there working on track position, basically, is what he's saying, guys. They think that the other guys are going to have to stop as well, so they're not going to have to change tires next time. Let's go to Bill Venturini.
Well, the number 10, that's quick forward of Scott Riggs. Just as that yellow came out, radio said, I cut a right rear tire. We finally got some good luck. As far as the 59 car, Stacy Compton, they think they've got a hole in the radiator. Last word we heard was it's 260 and climbing.
So the Kingsford Chevrolet, Johnsonville, about to cook the motor. A little barbecue.
Mark, come on.
Not good. Not good.
It's not good at all.
Not a very good pun, and not very good news either for Stacy Compton. Here's Brian Vickers. He's trying to get down underneath Jay Sauter. Sauter finished fourth here a year ago, so it's not really a huge surprise to see him up front in that Food Country USA car. He's done a pretty good job this afternoon. He stayed out under that last caution for track position. Brian Vickers will slip by into the third spot. And then Jason Keller to the inside of Sauter. And there's Todd Bodine popping up again in that number 92. He just won't go away.
Well, they made some adjustments on the car. Obviously, they're trying to work their tire strategy like everybody else. They've got themselves some respectable track position here, 142 laps into the race.
Todd now a good run, and it will take over that fourth position from Jay Sauter. Sauter still running pretty strong there on the outside lane, making it tough. And Kevin Grubb now moving into the picture. Grubb running in the seventh spot. He had a great qualifying run yesterday. And in that Joe D. Messina machine, he's doing pretty well this afternoon.
We saw Mike Bliss get into the back of
David Rudiman.
And David did a great job saving that car. Boy, that was near disaster.
Those two paint jobs look like they're team cars. red and white. There's the 20. Right behind him, the 87, the Cellular One machine of David Ruderman. Bobby Hamilton Jr., he's out front, 2.6 seconds ahead of the second place battle, Brian Dickers and Jason Keller. Jason Keller came here about a month ago, was freezing cold, and I asked him, why in the world would you come and test here when you run so well here in the past, especially at that time of the year? And he said, look, they give out a Gibson guitar for winning this race. I want one. I've wanted one for a long time. Going back to the days he ran the All-American 400 over the old track here in Nashville, the Fairgrounds Speedway. And he said, I've run top five like about eight times between that place and this place. I want that guitar.
Well, he's got a race car that could win one. He's doing a great job and really putting a lot of pressure on Brian Vickers right now.
So Brian Vickers was 43rd earlier this afternoon after spinning. Now he's charged his way all the way back to the second spot. Here's the side-by-side battle for fourth. Shane Beal had it. Todd Bodine just overpowers him at the end of the front straightaway. Bobby Hamilton Jr. continues to lead. It's grown to 2.8 seconds over the second place car, Brian Vickers. The NASCAR Busch Series and FX presented by Subway is coming right back. With 75 laps to go in the Pepsi 300, Bobby Hamilton Jr., the hometown favorite, is the leader of this race, but his lead is shrinking now to just over 2 seconds. It was close to three over Brian Vickers. You see Vickers in that blue and white machine coming into the picture. Jason Keller about three car lengths behind him. They are slowly, ever so slowly, reeling in Bobby Hamilton Jr. about maybe a half mile per hour, 1 mile per hour faster the last few laps.
Yeah, second, third, fourth, and fifth place cars right there in your picture. They're slowly gaining on the leader. And I think what's happened again is Bobby's picked up that push late in the run that his crew chief Fred Rank was talking about earlier. And now he's having a little bit of corner problem, handling problem right in the center of the corner. Can't get his car to turn. And these guys are really making time.
And you see how Brian Vickers has slowly chopped into the advantage that Bobby Hamilton has over his GMAC Chevrolet. Vickers looking for his first Busch Series win. Bobby Hamilton Jr. trying to get his first win at Nashville. Both want it pretty badly. And again, you can visually see how close Vickers is now. At one point, it was almost a full back straightaway. And now he's looming a little bit larger when Bobby Hamilton Jr. looks out that rearview mirror.
Well, that's going to slow Brian up just a little bit. He caught that lap car right in the center of the corner. You know, it's all about timing and trying to figure out where you're going to make the pass on that lap traffic as they run the bottom groove, and you've got to go around the outside of them.
Just moments ago, a tough break for Coy Gibbs. He slowed on the back straightaway, came down pit road, took the hard left, and went to the garage area, so he will not get his third straight top 10 finish. And he will not, for the fifth time this year, be the top Ray Bestis rookie finisher of the race. Right now, it looks like that belongs to Chad Blunt. He is 13th. Here's David Green, David Ruderman. This is a battle for the eighth spot. Meanwhile, Bobby Hamilton Jr. continues the lead. It's now down to 1.4 seconds over Brian Vickers. The NASCAR Busch Series on FX, presented by Subway. Hey, NASCAR fans, you still have a chance to be the official Grand Marshal at a 2004 Winston Cup race. It's the Be a NASCAR Grand Marshal for a Day contest. Tune into the first hour after the green flag drops for each of Fox's or FX's 2003 Winston Cup races. Look for the secret number on the animated car, then log on to NASCAR.com or FoxSports.com on Lycos and enter this number for your chance to win. The Be a NASCAR Grand Marshal for a Day contest will continue tomorrow from Martinsville, Virginia on Fox. And I understand that as the Grand Marshal, you get to throw the green flag, but also empty maybe Daryl's trash. You wash Larry's car.
What an illustrious position.
Absolutely. Shows you the glamour of big-time auto racing.
There you have it.
Speaking of which, Brian Vickers trying to get a little bit of it, still running in that number two spot, has closed to within 1 second of Bobby Hamilton Jr. And Glenn Jarrett has caught up with Brian Vickers, crew chief.
And Lance McGrew is talking to Brian right now as he goes by in front of him. Lance, you guys had a rough start to the race with the spin, but it looks like you saved the best for last. He's really closing in.
Yeah, the car's been really good all day. Had that spin at the beginning of the race, had to go to the back. Brian's just driving the wheels off of it. I'd like to say hey to Ricky back in Charlotte. We're going to try to get one for you.
Well, of course, he's talking about Ricky Hendrick, who owns the car, and Mr. Rick Hendrick is also up on the war wagon beside of Lance here. We can't see him from this vantage point, but he is here. So they really think highly of this guy, guys, and he has got a car that looks like maybe the one to beat right now.
Ricky Hendrick, the official car owner of this Brian Vickers machine. Of course, it helps to have the big boss around as well, his dad Rick, overlooking things. And last night, Kyle Busch, their young driver that will run some Busch Series races later this year, won the ARCA event here at the Nashville Super Speedway. Here's Ashton Lewis Jr., pretty solid run for him today. The Virginia driver trying to hold off David Green. Green in that green and blue Pontiac right behind the blue Chevrolet of Ashton Lewis Jr. Follows his tire tracks down to turn one.
David Green, you know, he's still got a great race car, you know, due to the last yellow pit stops, lost a lot of track position, but he's been very patient, working his way back up through these guys. As his crew chief said, they want to be in position to win this race when it comes down to it at the end.
That battle, 4.2 seconds behind the leader, Bobby Hamilton Jr. He's got some company. Brian Vickers is almost there. You see Vickers now in the camera shot, right up tight on Bobby Hamilton Jr. Vickers really getting a good run up out of the corners.
Boy, his car's really getting through the center, and I think that's where Bobby Hamilton Jr.'s car has gone away. Looks like he's just a little lazy getting it turned in the center of the corner. And the five car right there just makes a good run, able to keep a lane lower on corner exit. And that's gonna what's gonna let him make the pass right here on the front straightaway for the lead.
Here they are working down the front stretch. And Vickers will mow Bobby Hamilton down. He'll take over that number one spot. You see a little bit of a wave from Brian Vickers. Hey, thanks for the room, big guy. Let's get an update from Glenn Jarrett.
Well, like Lance McGrew said, Brian's car is working very well. On the other hand, Bobby Hamilton's car, the car is okay. I talked to Fred Wanky. It's just that that set of tires that they have on there right now has been on that car for a little over 100 miles. Remember the last time that they pitted, they did not change tires. Fred Wanky says, hey, man, we're just out of tires. We got a set here. If the caution comes out, we've got a set, or we can change any time under green. So Bobby Hamilton just out of tires right now, guys.
Brian Vickers, first time today he has led. He is the eighth different leader here at the Nashville Super Speedway. Jason Keller now also catching Bobby Hamilton Jr. What an amazing day if Vickers wins this race. He spins early, coming out of turn number four into the grass. NASCAR does not throw the yellow flag. He comes out onto the racetrack in front of then leader Randy LaJoy, pulls away from LaJoy, gets the yellow flag, and then just scratches and claws his way back to the top.
Here he is leading the race.
You can't give up, right? Till the checkered flag, you just can't do it.
That is what this race team is all about. You know, even after their unfortunate circumstances in Texas, these guys are determined they're going to put Brian Vickers in victory lane.
Here's a look at what happened to Brian Vickers earlier today. I mean earlier. I mean just after this race got underway, lap 7. Trying to get inside Kerry Earnhardt.
Loses the back of the car, does the smart thing, turns it down, tries to keep it in the infield grass. NASCAR did not throw a yellow, and as you said, he came out just ahead of the leader at that time, who was Randy LaJoy, who was really dominating the early portion of the race, but he was able to pull away, and at that time, we knew he had a great race car, and he's showing it right now.
And you look at him spinning through the grass. That grass, it may look smooth and even, but it's not, so it's lucky that he didn't get that car bobbing up and down and maybe hurt his air dam. Here's David Green now driving underneath Todd Bodine. This is the battle for fifth. Bodine, it looks like, will let him go. David Green continues to move forward. He led this race earlier today. But Brian Vickers is out front, pulling away from Bobby Hamilton Jr. by 1.2 seconds. That's the gap right now. The NASCAR Busch Series on FX, presented by Subway, comes back to Nashville in just a moment. 50 laps to to go with the NASCAR Busch Series on FX presented by Subway at the Nashville Super Speedway. Teenager Brian Vickers continuing to show the way. He's begun to stretch away from Bobby Hamilton Jr. 2 seconds the gap now. There's Vickers, and there's the battle for the second spot. Hamilton Jr. has it. Jason Keller closing in on him, and then catching up to Keller, the 20 machine. That is Mike Bliss.
These guys are really putting on a heck of a battle here. Bobby Jr.'s kind of drifted back to them. He really hasn't been able to do anything, and these guys have caught up.
Here's Ashton Lewis Jr. trying to get by Todd Bodine. They're trying to work around the lap machine. That's the 54 of Hermie Sadler. Todd really protecting that inside line, using Sadler to hold off Ashton Lewis Jr. Let's go back down to pit lane and Bill Venturini.
Well, I'm in a 92 pit, and they've got the same problem that Bobby Hamilton Jr. does. They've got a lot of laps on these tires, and they're just hoping now for a yellow, because they've got four fresh tires here. They've got like almost 60 laps on these tires, and that's why they're starting to fade back just a little.
Yeah, there's a group of cars out here that got four tires sitting on pit road they can put on under yellow. They'd like nothing more than the yellow come out, put those tires on. And there's a group of cars out there that can't put any tires on. They want it to continue on in green flag conditions so then they can put their four tires, make a green flag stop and get some tires on their car later on in the run.
In the split screen, the leader, Brian Vickers, and the number five, then the side-by-side battle, Ashton Lewis. On the bottom of the racetrack, Todd Bodine up high. And now Lewis will flash on by, dropping Todd Bodine back to the seventh position. Ashton Lewis Jr. told me last year both times that he came here, he had a top 10 car, just not a top 10 finish. And I said, okay, I hear a lot of drivers telling me that every time I go into the garage area. He said, no, I mean it. He said, I hope to prove it today. And he's done it.
Oh, he's doing a great job. That team has really, really done a great job all year. They just have not had the finishes to go along with the effort. And they've certainly got the effort again today, and hopefully they can come out of here with the finish they deserve.
This is a very talented team, and I really think that Ashton Lewis Jr. could have a breakout season. I mean, he needs a couple of good runs, a couple of good finishes to get a little bit of positive momentum, and then maybe after that, things will really start to break his way. Here's Johnny Sauter. That's the Payday Monte Carlo. Fourth time out in this car this year. He shares the ride with Kevin Harvick for Richard Childress Racing. And I believe Glenn Jarrett has an update on his situation.
Yes, Mark, I do. And the fact is that most everybody I've talked to down here, in fact, we're getting ready for Bobby Hamilton Jr.'s pit stop shortly. But everybody else is going to have to pit except the 21 car. They're going to try to make it all the way. Johnny has dropped back now. He is saving fuel. So by my record, by my estimation, he's the only guy out there that can do that right now. But he's trying to save fuel to make it all the way.
Glenn, he's got a long way to go. I mean, if you're going to try to do it, you've got to start saving now. Try to stay on the lead lap, correct, and feather for everything you got. Here's Brian Vickers again, the lead machine. 1.5 seconds ahead of Bobby Hamilton Jr. You see Shane Meal, the 48 car, coming back out onto the racetrack. He's just made his stop. Tomorrow, 12:30 Eastern time on Fox, the Winston Cup Series at Martinsville. Bobby Hamilton Jr. looks like he's coming on to pit road. Jason Keller and Mike Bliss both roar on by his machine. So now Keller second, the red and white car, the cranberry colored number 20. Mike Bliss is now in the third position. These are scheduled green flag pit stops now for some of these cars. Following Bobby Hamilton Jr. down pit road is Todd Bodine.
These are the guys making pit stops that, let's throw it to Bill on pit road.
I'm in the Todd Bodine pit right now, and it looks like they're gonna do four tires, but they're not stickers. They're putting on a set of scuffs. Let's go down to Glenn.
Bobby Hamilton is in, a two-tire stop for him, right sides only. They originally planned to change four. They went back to their tire cash back there and picked out two different tires than what they had on the wall, changed two tires for Bobby Hamilton. He's good to go the rest of the way.
You see Hamilton now on that inside road that will lead him back to the back straightaway, coming up to full song in that red number 25. Brian Vickers continuing to lead. Here's how Todd Bodine got into his pits.
Got in there a little hot. Fortunately, he got stopped in time and didn't go over the line and receive any kind of a penalty from NASCAR, but he got it in there in a hurry.
Looked like a cowboy. Whoa, pulling back on the reins there just a bit. Kind of apropos here in Nashville.
His guys did a great job, though, of, you know, making sure they got all their work done, got it done correctly and in a hurry.
Here again, the battle for the second spot. Jason Keller trying to hold on to the real estate from Mike Bliss. There you see the leader, Brian Vickers. A couple of lap cars now separating him from that battle for second place. Here again, Mike Bliss trying to get a good run up out of the corners, but can't quite get enough bite there to get up underneath Jason Keller.
Well, Jason's working just well enough. And as we said earlier, Mike doing a great job getting through the center of the corner, gets up to him and just can't quite keep the car on the bottom to make a run off the corner.
If you missed it yesterday, Mike Bliss, a really rough day. He crashed in qualifying and then had an engine let go, and they had to change it after happy hour. Brian Vickers is your leader, 1.2 seconds ahead of Jason Keller and Mike Bliss. NASCAR Busch Series on FX, presented by Subway. Laps complete in the Pepsi 300, make that 192. Brian Vickers is the leader, 2.2 seconds over Jason Keller. A quick break, we'll come back for some green flag pit stops from Nashville.
And leader Brian Vickers has brought his car down pit road for a shot of fuel. They put about five and a half seconds of fuel in the car, sent him on the way. No tire change. He should be good to go. So he came in a little earlier than was expected, so the fuel pressure must have been fluctuating.
Jason Keller coming in, Glenn, right in front of you. He's about to make his final stop.
Okay, Mark, I see him, and Jason Keller was due to come in on lap 200. He is three laps early as well, and they are going to the right side. They had planned to change only fuel only, but he needed more fuel than Brian Vickers did, so they had time to change right side tires. Jason is down and away as well with two fresh right side tires.
You saw where that stopped for Jason Keller, 10 seconds long for him. That turns over the top spot to Mike Bliss with David Green in the number two position. And again, lurking out there is Johnny Sauter. Sauter is now eighth, and we got word earlier that they were going to try to stretch it to the end. They don't have a car that can go up there and take the top spot away, but maybe they can steal a victory. That's what they're out to do right now.
That's a long time on fuel. Mm. He's got to do a lot of saving. Right now, Scott Riggs is bringing the number 10 car onto pit road.
Riggs running fifth. Again, the pit road speed, 45 miles per hour. Bill Venturini is there.
10 cars in the pits right now, and all he's getting is gas. And he's gone. Quick pit stop.
That one didn't take long at all. That had to be under 5 seconds.
Certainly, and you know, great strategy. Try to get back out on the racetrack here as quick as possible. Keep your track position. Obviously, they were happy with that set of tires. Trying to make sure that they do the right decision here at the end of the race to try to keep themselves up towards the front.
Mike Bliss trying to come up on the number one to lap him. That's David Stremme. Jason Keller is in the wall.
Caution's out.
And that one is going to hurt a number of drivers. Tough break for Jason Keller, who has run top five just about all afternoon long. That is the seventh caution flag. Keller, it looks like, might have had a tire problem the way he's leaned up against the wall.
Looks like the right front of the car is down, like possibly a suspension failure or a tire blowout.
And if there is a guy that really wanted to win badly, it was Jason Keller. The yellow flag, Brett, the 5 car, the 25, what does it do for them?
Oh, this is just devastating. You know, they're trapped a lap down. Changes the whole complexity of the race. The guys that stayed out, didn't make any pit stops, they're in a catbird seat right now.
23 laps to go, only that many.
Looks like we've got 8 cars on the lead lap.
And Jason Keller, you see him, he has dropped the window net, which is the sign to the safety crew that he is relatively okay. Here's the leader, Mike Bliss, coming onto pit road. Final pit stop. Let's see what these guys will do for strategy. Right behind him, David Green.
So the red and white Rockwell Automation Monte Carlo of Joe Gibbs Racing slides into his pit in front of Bill Venturini.
Strictly gas and go. They have no tires left. The windshield tear up, and he's gone about 3 seconds. Let's go to Glenn.
Okay, Bill, David Green's just now getting to his pit space, and this will be gas and go as well. I'm counting. That's one, two, three and a half, 4 seconds worth of gas is all he put into David Green. And he comes out behind Mike Bliss and the 46 car of Ashton Lewis. Back to Bill Venturini.
Well, the 46 car just came in, gas and go, no tires.
So Ashton Lewis, let's see who will lead the cars off of pit road. It looks like Lewis's car is going to be number one, followed by Mike Bliss. Maybe another first-time winner coming up here at Nashville. Wait and see. Closing in on the checkered flag at Nashville, here's what's happened so far. Brian Vickers spinning early, lap number 7, didn't hit anything. Same could not be said for Chase Montgomery. Blows an engine, pow, hits the wall. Chris Bingham, about the same place. Brian Vickers gets tapped. Ooh, that one hurt. Oh, two cars there. Randy LaJoy gets a little bit of help. He led early. He won't lead late. Brian Vickers comes back from that spin, takes over the lead. The NASCAR Busch Series here on FX, presented by Subway. I'm Mark Garrow with Brett Bodine, Bill Venturini, Glenn Jarrett at the Nashville Super Speedway. Here is the leader of this race, Johnny Sauter, the payday Monte Carlo, looking for a big payday. We heard earlier from Glenn Jarrett that we're going to try to stretch the fuel mileage. They thought they might be a half lap short. These caution laps have to be a godsend for them, Brett.
If they were only a half lap short, these caution laps played right into their hand. They're leading the race now, but do they have enough race car to keep that lead?
On the tail end of the lead lap, when we restart this race, is going to be Brian Vickers, Bobby Hamilton Jr., Ron Hornaday, Scott Riggs, and Martin Truex. And right now, Johnny Sauter is the leader. Ashton Lewis Jr. is second, followed by Mike Bliss, David Green, and David Ruderman.
Hey, Tom, I told this guy you make a great sandwich. Tell him.
Well, I start with a rich...
Only at Sears. Where else?
The NASCAR Busch Series on FX, presented by Subway, getting set to restart this race at the Nashville Super Speedway. Quick update from Glenn Jarrett.
Well, Mark, down on pit road, Bobby Hamilton's been talking to his crew. He thinks that he may have a tire going down, but to get ready to restart, they're deciding right now if they're going to bring him in or not. It's going to be death to him if he does, because right now he's on the tail end of the lead lap. Also, the 57 car of Jason Keller that crashed and brought out this caution. They had just put right side tires on. Jason radioed the crew, said he ran over something on the racetrack. And one more, the 19 car of Chad Blunt, who was leading earlier. He thought that he had an engine going south on him a little bit earlier on. They've decided now it's some kind of exhaust leak, or it's causing the engine to sound very, very strange to Chad, but the car is still up to power. He came in for gas and go on that caution.
And Chad Blunt is on the lead lap, running seventh. When they take the green flag, there are going to be 18 laps to go. The leader, Johnny Sauter, trying to hold off Ashton Lewis. Down in the laps down lane, Ron Hornaday in the number two for Richard Childress Racing. That's the AC Delco Chevrolet. And again, Vickers is on the tail end of the lead lap. So is Hornaday and Riggs and Todd Bodine. And back there in that mess, you see the orange and white car now zigging its way to the inside. That's Johnny Sauter. He is the actual leader of this race.
Big group of cars that got back on the tail end of the lead lap here on this yellow exchange, and they're hoping for a caution.
Look at that battle for the second spot. Just behind Johnny Sauter, a lot of traffic in front of Sauter. Then you see the red and white number 20 of Mike Bliss now on the back bumper of Ashton Lewis. They play a little bumper tag working out of turn number two. And one car separating Lewis from the leader, Johnny Sauter. Sauter's not conserving fuel now, right? He's got his leg through the floorboard.
He's using it all he's got right now.
Johnny Sauter with Kevin Grubb. Ron Hornaday up ahead. Hornaday, of course, his teammate at RCR Racing for this race. now Sauter will cut underneath him. Then it's Jay Sauter. Maybe his brother will run a little bit of blocking back for him.
He's doing a good job, but Ashton Lewis has now got on the inside of him going down to turn three. Oh, contact as they got down in the corner. Jay obviously didn't see Ashton down the inside.
Or Ashton said, look, I don't have enough time for this. I give you a little nudge and I can get after that first place car. There's your gap now, first to second. And then back to third place, Mike Bliss.
There's David Green.
And he's coming.
He's coming in a hurry. He's had one of the best cars all day. And as his crew chief said, they just want to be in position at the end of the race to win this thing. And they've accomplished that. Now it's up to David to get it to the front.
15 laps to go. Not much time to get there. And Johnny Sauter all day long hasn't perhaps showed his whole hand. He's been back there mired in about 11th to 15th all day with a good but not great car, but they certainly conserved a lot of it for the end and their fuel. And so many times in NASCAR racing these days, it comes down to track position. You got it at the end, you can maybe make it pay off. And right now, Butch Hilton, that crew, they've made the right decisions, the right calls to put Johnny Sauter on the point. Now it's up to him.
Oh, they sure have done the right calls, made all the right calls. And Ashton Lewis, Mike Bliss, David Green, they're chasing that 21 car. And he's doing a great job leading this race. Like you said, kind of a silent guy all day, but he's trying to cash in on the payday.
No pun intended.
No pun intended.
Johnny Sauter, fourth time out in this car this year. He shares the ride with Kevin Harvick over at Richard Childress Racing. And you look, he had his first run at Darlington. He finished fifth in this car. And then trouble the last 2 weeks at Texas was 37th, at Talladega 26th. But still, Johnny Sauter looking very strong right now. And he came into this race. He also drives for the Curb Agajanian team. And he came into this race 11th in the driver point. So this is certainly going to help that as well.
It certainly is. But I'll tell you what, it's getting crowded at the front of this field. These guys are closing in. David Green, Ashton Lewis, Mike Bliss, chasing that 21 car, and they're doing all they can. Everybody's pulling out all the stops.
There you see the top four cars now running together. About two car lengths, each separation from each position. Down the back straightaway, Ashton Lewis is there. He has never won a Busch Series race. He has got to be chomping at the bit. Johnny Sauter has a lone victory. And given the struggles that he had last season, he would dearly love to break back into victory lane. Mike Bliss, after winning the Craftsman Truck Series race last season, trying to win his first Busch Series event. And David Green, the wily veteran back there, he's a former Busch Series champion. He knows what it takes to win and also take the title. He's back there in the fourth spot.
I'll tell you what, that 46 car, he is running down that straightaway. He makes up a lot of ground on that 21 car. Not getting through the corner so well, but he is getting down the straightaway with 10 to go.
Let's get an update on Johnny Sauter from Glenn Jarrett.
Well, guys, I just asked Butch Hilton, the crew chief, if they could definitely make it. And Butch held up his fingers just close together. He said, it's going to be very, very close. The caution flag helped, but they are still very close to not being able to make it.
And there's no way to conserve at this point. He's got to just run it for all it's worth and just let the chips fall where they may. Ashton Lewis Jr. just has that 46 hung out. And here's David Green going after Mike Bliss. This is the battle for third. Green may have the best car right now.
He's looking awfully good on corner exit. He's made a great run on Mike Bliss. Going to complete the pass down here in the middle of turns one and two.
He's getting the best run up out of the bottom of the corners. He will prove very troublesome as they work their way down the back straightaway when they come back to the line. Seven laps to go. Johnny Sauter trying to hold on. David Green trying to scramble back to the front. He takes a look under Ashton Lewis Jr. But Lewis will slam the door. You see Sauter opening up the door to the inside, but he gets such a great run. Sweeping off into the turn one, he's able to hold off that number 46.
Ashton Lewis is really going down the straightaway, but he can't get through the corners. He gives up three, four car lengths through the corners, and all he can do is make it back up down the straightaway. He just gets back to the back bumper of Sauter.
Great racing at the Nashville Super Speedway. Look at Bliss. He's not giving up on this. He goes to the outside of David Green, trying to retake third and mount one final assault on leader Johnny Sauter.
Look at that runner on the outside of David Green. That is impressive.
He just powers by. Jay Sauter is in the grass. And that is along the front straightaway, but he is trying to make his way off the surface in a place where NASCAR will call it at least safe enough to keep this race under green. You see Sauter's car now trying to get behind the wall, and it does. Meanwhile, up front, here's Ashton Lewis Jr. again going after Johnny Sauter. A little bit closer going into one. Sauter has to give him the inside line. Can Ashton Lewis Jr. pull it off?
That's as close as he's been on corner exit. Let's see if he can make a move at the end of the straightaway. No, cannot pull out.
Well, they come back to the start-finish line. The NASCAR starter is only holding up one hand, signifying the laps. That is how close we are to the checkered flag. Johnny
Sauter. Laps to go.
Johnny Sauter trying to hold on. Ashton Lewis again climbs to his inside in turn one.
Ashton makes a great run down this front straightaway, but just doesn't have enough to get there and hold that inside lane as they go through turns one and two. David Green back on the inside of Mike Bliss. They keep swapping that third position.
And that is really good news for Johnny Sauter. While those two duke it out, all he has to worry about is Ashton Lewis.
Well, right now, Johnny Sauter would probably love to see David Green get up there and aggravate Ashton Lewis. Ashton will start playing some defense instead of playing offense only against Johnny Sauter.
There are the top three cars poking his head out to the inside, the nose of that machine of Ashton Lewis. Can't get inside Johnny Sauter going into the corner. It's getting down to crunch time. Here's David Green inside Ashton Lewis Jr., the Timberwolf Pontiac, trying to fly by that Civil Air Patrol Chevrolet. He does. That's bad news for Johnny Sauter. When they come back to the start-finish line, the white flag will wave. Sauter trying to hold on for the final lap and a half here in Nashville.
David's coming. I mean, he is coming in a hurry. His car runs through the center of the corner so strong. He's there.
David Green has caught the leader, Johnny Sauter. They take the white flag, a mile and a third to go. Green looks to the inside. Sauter, though, will beat him to turn one.
Johnny didn't close the door. He made like he was going to close the door, but didn't close it. David's got a run coming up out of turn two. He's alongside.
They nearly touch midway down the back straightaway. It's a horsepower battle to turn number three. David Green wins it. Sauter will try to come back on the outside.
Wow, what a move. David Green pulled it off.
David Green on the white flag took the lead and has won here at Nashville.
Woo! What a finish.
David Green has won it in dramatic fashion. Johnny Sauter was able to hold on until the very end. But David Green, the former Busch Series champion, has found his way back to victory lane. Here's a look at the winning pass by David Green. It came out of turn number two. The door was open and he walked through.
Johnny made on the front straightaway like he was going to pull down to the inside, but he left that inside lane open, and David's car, getting through the center of the corner so strong, was able to make a move up out of two and get alongside on the back straightaway. Johnny made a great try to drive it back in there, but David's car was just so strong in that bottom lane.
David Green's sixth career win on the Busch Series. And he is the first Busch regular to win this year. And he's going to have some fun because the Timberwolf Pontiac is about to howl here on the front stretch. And you hear this big crowd here at Nashville cheering David Green. He's a very popular guy. And Brett, he cut his teeth here in the Nashville area early on in his racing career.
I'm sure David considers this like his home track. Certainly all the racing he's done in this area. And it's great to see David back in victory lane.
43 years old. Stands up to the young guys today. Hey, there's one for you, Brett.
There you go. I like it when one of them middle-aged guys pulls off a victory.
You know, you might say that David has a few gray hairs, but he's got all gray hair, but he doesn't drive like he's ready for the rocket chair. And right now he came into this race sixth in the point standings. This will certainly help him. And David really believes this team this year is good enough to win the championship. Already they have won two pole positions and have now made a trip to victory lane. Or about to make a trip to victory lane. He's trying to weave his way through some of the heaviest traffic he's had to deal with so far here today. Let's get down to Bill Venturini. He's standing by with a happy but disappointed runner-up.
Well, I'm here with Johnny Sauter. One lap to go to really hit the big payday, but you can't be disappointed. Good run today.
I really was. I mean, our payday Chevrolet wasn't as good as we thought it was going to be, and we had a brake problem last night. The car was real loose, and we overcorrected by tightening the car up, and all in all, a good day for us. I mean, feel like we had a 10th place car and we got a second out of it, so we'll just go on.
And definitely another good run for the Sauter family.
Outstanding day for Johnny Sauter, and again, very quiet. He and Butch Hilton, his crew chief, they obviously had a plan. It was about track position, about getting it at the end, and they did that and nearly won the race. But the man in victory lane is with Glenn Jarrett.
Well, thanks, Mark. He's trying to get out of the car. He's still unbuckling all the safety paraphernalia there. He takes the Hans device off. David Green, what a fantastic job. That's one of the best jobs I have ever seen on the last lap. Come on out of there, man. Tell me about it. David climbs out now. The crew is just now getting here, getting high fives from them. He's going to celebrate just a little. Oh, and we get a little wet. We'll let this finish up first here, guys. Mob scene down here.
Glenn, I hope David, don't mess up your hair there.
It's okay. It's been messed up a long time. David, great job. One of the best last laps I have ever seen. Did you think you could do it?
My car was good all day long, and we elected to come in and get some gas, and hopefully it'd cycle back out, you know, where it'd get back up front. But, man, we were having such a hard time with traffic, and I burnt the right rear off of it. But I knew once I could get up there, I think I could. You got Johnny there, but great race, and I just can't say enough for my team. I want to say hi to Diane, Austin, and Kaylee. Wish they were here, but my team's awesome, and thanks to Clarence Burr and Jeff Purvis back home watching. He got this team on a roll last year, and we've tried to continue on here, but our Pontiac was awesome again, and Bill Davis engines were good, and Jason and I just hit it off. This whole team, wonderful job, and I'm so happy.
I can tell you're happy, man. Look, we talked to you before the race. You seem confident all weekend. You seem to know that maybe you can come home again to the Nashville area, get you another victory.
Well, to be honest with you, this wasn't my favorite track in Nashville. My favorite one was the Fairgrounds, but this car works so good, and it's happened every race this year. I went to the racetrack. Jason Radcliffe and the whole team has done a wonderful job. I just simply get in there and drive that thing, and it's so much fun, so much fun.
Outstanding job, David Green, his first win since June 22nd, 1996. Here's Bill.
I'm with Ashton Lewis, who drives the family-owned Civil Air Patrol Chevrolet. Good run today, buddy.
It was. This is what the Civil Air Patrol and Chevrolet needed. You know, we've had great cars this whole year. We've had top 10 race cars and just haven't been able to bring it home. We battled back from a bad pit stop earlier on, just kept our heads down and kept digging. And this is what this team's been showing all year long. We just haven't been able to put it together, and it was just a great run for us. We did fuel only earlier in the race, and it made me tight. And I knew we were going to probably be a little bit tight on that last run. And I couldn't roll through the center like Johnny could. And I tried my line. I tried everything I could. The only chance I had of getting was kind of making him a late move, getting off in there and taking a chance of taking us both out. And we needed a great finish, and that's what we got today. And that's what this whole team needed.
Well, for about the last 10 laps, you definitely were handling down the straightaway. I got to tell you that. A couple times we thought you were going to put the move going on, but it just like you said, just couldn't quite hold on in the center.
Yeah, I don't know if they ran a little bit more gear than we did. We talked about putting more gear in it this morning, but figured we'd just be better off. We didn't want to take a chance of blowing the engine up, and you know, this whole Roush Chevrolet engine, it did a great job all day long, and you can't complain about when you gain on an RCR car like that at the end of the straightaway. But it's a great run for this team, and this is what we needed. We needed the confidence in the shot, and this is great, you know.
A good confidence builder for the team.
It really is. We've had great cars all year long. You know, we hang our own bodies in-house, and with the new body, I kept telling the guys, you know, we're getting a good start on this. I think we're learning it, and we learned a lot yesterday in happy hour, and we're a little bit disappointed in our qualifying effort. But, you know, we thought we had it figured out and what we missed the boat on, so we tried it for happy hour, and I guess it paid off. I think we learned a little bit today.
Well, thanks for an exciting finish, and back up to the booth, guys.
Let's take another look at the winning pass of David Green. It came on the white flag out of turn two.
Johnny Sauter just not able to keep his car in that low lane, and David, as he spoke of his interview and
victory lane, how good his car worked all day in the bottom, and it sure did. Johnny trying to
put a little
move on him there, but David held his ground and drove it down in turn three and completed the pass.
It really was a great finish for all of the three cars that came home top three in this race. David Green with the win. Johnny Sauter, big confidence booster for him. And then, of course, Ashton Lewis Jr., good run for those guys. So but you see the victory lane mob. David Green, the champion in 1994. This is really the first chance he's had a chance to run for the championship again since then, I believe. And they really do think they've got a shot at it this year. He was number six in the standings coming into this race, and he'll be higher when we leave.
I think everybody in the garage area thinks David Green's got a shot at this championship. You know, he's a veteran. He knows exactly what it takes to win a championship. This race team is a quality, fast race cars, great pit stops, and, you know, today they got their first victory, and they're certainly headed on their way to chase this championship.
And there's the really cool guitar being brought into victory lane, the Gibson guitar that goes to the winner, David Green. He plays air guitar. I'm not sure he could play that very well, but I do know he
plays
a great
air guitar. That's a beautiful piece of equipment. I saw it in the driver's meeting this morning, and it was really pretty.
David Ruderman finished fifth today. We talked about what a great run he had throughout the afternoon. He's standing by with Bill Venturini.
I'm with the big Ruderman. We joked about that yesterday. Good run today, buddy. You put the your one up front for the Nemechek family.
Yeah, I tell you, I gotta thank Selwyn. The Selwyn Chevrolet was just, I mean, it was just really good. I think some of my inexperience showed up. Again, I gotta thank Hills Brothers also for, giving me the freedom to be able to do this. I'm part of their copper break of a lifetime deal, and we're gonna go to California in a couple weeks with that car. And Joe Nemechek, you can't ask for a better organization. Brian, Patty, all the crew, they really cut my learning curve down a lot. I gotta thank Cell One for just taking a chance on me, because every time you see that car, it's up front, and I think we're pretty good today. We just missed it by a little bit.
Well, I'm definitely looking forward to see you running up front more this year.
Thank you.
David Ruderman, a good run. If not for a bad break at the end of the race at Texas, he might have two straight top five runs. He is certainly the real day, certainly the real deal. A very happy crew jumps off pit wall to celebrate the victory of David Green. We're coming back after this. The NASCAR Busch Series presented by Subway here on FX. It's over here at the Nashville Super Speedway. But it wasn't over till the final lap, the final half lap. David Green making the pass down the backstretch, moving to the inside of Johnny Sauter, goes on to win his sixth Busch Series event, his first of 2003. Great finish. Glenn Jarrett standing by with another driver who finished top 10. Glenn?
Yeah, and he had a much better car than that, Mark. Brian Vickers, if you look on the scoreboard, he finished ninth, but Brian, looked like you had the car to win this thing, and that late caution came out and bit you.
We really did. You know, it took the whole team, and the team gave me what I needed. You know, I busted my butt there early on. I wasn't nobody but myself, and we gathered it back up. They calmed me down. I calmed myself down. We took off, and we went from last to first. You know, the guys gave me good pit stops all day. They did an awesome job. Lance made some unbelievable calls, and, you know, the GMAC crew led the whole race. I mean, not the whole race, but we led for a long time, and I think they know we were here, and it wasn't our day, but we're just going to keep doing this every week, and I think eventually it'll come.
Well, I think so, too. And, Brian, let's talk a little bit about your relationship with the Hendricks. I mean, they seem to pick you out of just kind of out of the dark, and everybody's saying, wow, they're really, really smart. But, you know, you had a lot going for you, but tell us how that came about.
Oh, that was Ricky, my car owner. He gave me a call up and wanted if I wanted to drive the 5 car. And, you know, it's always been a dream of mine to drive for Hendrick Motorsports and a Chevy and have a great sponsor, GMAC and CarQuest, and they gave it to me, a great crew, and it just – you have to wake up and pinch myself every morning. It's they give me what I need to go out here and win races, and eventually we'll get one.
You will. I agree with that wholeheartedly, and it won't be long. Now let's go to Bill Venturini.
I'm with Chad Blunt in the APP Dodge here. Good run today. Another top 10 for you.
Yeah, that's what we needed. We start out the year good at Daytona, and then we kind of struggle the next couple weeks. But then we think we got our program turned around after Texas, and now we had an awesome car here today. We just was running on 7 cylinders, about 50 to go there. So, I mean, who knows where we could have been with all 8.
Okay, now during the race, we talked about you leading the race. You've led here in the ARCA race. What was it like leading in the Busch race?
It was pretty cool. I knew the 46 car went behind me for the first time, you know, when you're leading out front here. But I was really, really had a good time, and hopefully that's where we can stay all year long.
Good run for the 19 car, Chad Blunt.
You see where the Busch Series is going. Those two drivers don't even look like they shave yet.
I'll tell you, this series has got a great future. NASCAR racing's got a great future with drivers like that.
Here's a look at the results presented by Subway. David Green, your winner. Stanton Barrett. The rest of the finishing order. About 13 cars failed to finish the race today. Let's go to Glenn Jarrett. I believe he's caught up with Mike Bliss.
I have indeed, Mark, and if there's a man who gets the award for having overcome the most difficulty this weekend, I guess, it's probably you, Mike Bliss. Had to start in the rear. You had a strong race car, though, to not to have much time on the track with this car after crashing your primary.
Yeah, we unloaded really well, so with the same setup we just threw on our backup car. And, you know, just can't say enough for these Rockwell Automation guys that Chevrolet was really fast. And, you know, I want to say the Fab guys, they've been working their tail off and they've been doing a great job. And I've just been keeping them busy and it's too bad. But, you know, we just got real tight at the end behind cars and I tried the outside and it wasn't bad, but you had to hit it just right. And kind of, I just couldn't get by those guys.
Well, it's some fast and furious racing. You and David Green were really almost trading some sheet metal there at the end. That was fun to watch anyway.
Well, I mean, I didn't want to hold. I know David was fast. I wanted to try to make that outside work, and I thought if I make it work, I might be able to get by those other two racing on the bottom. And I think it could have worked, but I just missed it down there a little bit, and it pushed up, and I had to wait on it. But, you know, we had a good run. I'm really happy with what we finished, and, you know, we'll just go on to the next race.
Well, congratulations. Great job all the way from last to fourth. Here's Bill.
I'm here with Bobby Hamilton Jr. Earlier today and yesterday, you told me we had the dominant car, we had the car to beat. You showed it today. If it wasn't for yellows, I think you would have laid it on him.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's disappointing because we know the best car did. I mean, it would have been me or the five, simple as that. You know, he had a stout car. But Ford, they've really, if it wasn't for them guys, we'd be in trouble. They took our cars in the wind tunnel and got them right for us. And this is the first 03 we rebuilt, and you've seen the product today. And had an awesome motor, Robert and Doug Yates, all them guys. Thanks out to all those Marines out there kicking butt. But an awesome day. After the last 2 weeks we've had, I'd have settled for a top 15. I'm disappointed we didn't win the thing because we were so good. But for some reason, it wasn't our day. It was the 37th day. But congratulations to him and everything. We'll just go on. This is the car we're going to carry to California. We're really on to something with the body stuff. And motor stuff's always been right. So we got a chance right now to win some races.
Well, with the way you ran today, you definitely had to build good team momentum for this.
This is what we needed. Like I said, we went from 7th to 17th in the points in the last 2 weeks. So we had to get a finish. We had to put ourselves in position, and we did. The caution bit us, but I'm here to tell you, if it's got my name attached to pit strategy, you can count on the caution every time. But it's something that we can build on. We can build this team on and go on and win some races and get back up in points and challenge for that championship.
Well, good luck. Let's go to you, Glenn.
Well, thanks, Bill. I've caught up with Stanton Barrett. Stanton. Good qualifying effort, good race effort. This is the kind of thing you guys are looking for.
Yeah, we definitely need to turn around. We've had some bad luck with this Autobahn Bojangles Ford, and my guys are great, Cowboy and the crew chief and Roush. They have great cars. We got back behind on some track position. We took four tires, other people took two, so it was just a battle to get back up in track position. But that long green flag stop, or that long green flag session, we definitely had a fast car. They made the right changes, and I drove my heart out, and we gained a lot of positions, so it was a fun day. A lot of people raced fair and clean, and it was good to be up front.
Well, congratulations. Great job. That is his career best finish, sixth place today, Mark.
Let's take a look at the point standings after race 8. Ron Hornaday moves up to the number 2 spot, minus 78 to Todd Bodine. David Green up to third, looking for that second title.
Mike Bliss is fourth. Shane Meehl in the fifth spot. Casey Kane, 11th. Look at what happened to Randy LaJoie. 16th coming in. He drops back to the 18th position. What a day we had here at the Nashville Super Speedway. We saw an absolutely great race. Brett, a little bit of everything. We saw some wrecks. We saw some side-by-side racing. And do we know drama at the end? There it was. Last lap pass, David Green over Johnny Sauter.
What a finish. You know, David Green, his crew played the cards right all day. They were concerned about their track position at the end, and they felt like they had the car to win the race if they could get it to the front. And David drove his heart out to get by those three cars to get to the leader and then made the pass on the last lap. Just what an outstanding finish.
Again, you can never give up. He was running fourth with five laps to go. It didn't look like he could clear Mike Bliss. He did. And then he got by Ashton Lewis a whole lot easier, and that really probably was the key, because if Ashton had held him up even a half lap more, he'd have been out of time.
Well, that's exactly right. You know, Ashton tried to put up a gallant fight, but David was too strong on corner exit. His car really got up out of the corner strong, made a pass there to get by Ashton, and it opened the door to chase down the leader. And he made a great move on the leader going down into turn one and completed at the end of the back straightaway.
It doesn't get any better than the last lap pass, right?
No, that's the best. Boy, those are the ones you always remember. And, you know, great run for a guy that we didn't include in the young group, but he's there as the champion.
So that's about it from the Nashville Super Speedway for FX. Here presented by Subway, David Green is the winner. Fantastic job. Brian Vickers, great day for him. For Glenn Jarrett and Bill Venturini, I'm Mark Carroll. For Brett Bodine, saying so long from Nashville, where we saw again just about everything you could ask for today in race 8 for the Busch Series in 2003. Some of that. An almost win by him, and the victory by that guy, David Green.